Time
and we're live.
It's the Good Mythical Morning podcast.
Oh, you found another one.
We haven't done that one yet, right?
No, we haven't.
Okay, I'm glad. I was worried that we already did that one.
How much longer can you keep this up?
Oh, we can keep it going for a long
time. I don't know what I'm going to do. I need help, you guys. Hey, submit your favorite podcast in the comments.
No, don't give him more shit. Actually, I found a new podcast you can steal.
Okay, good.
It's a good video game one. I'll link it to you later so you can...
I can say it next week.
We can frame ourselves as them. Welcome to the Roundabout Podcast. This is Willer, your host.
Oh, yeah, that's us.
This is Joe.
And I'm Bradley.
And we're just going to go straight into it.
We're jumping in. Only the best analysis for games.
We're not doing the intro. We're jumping straight to the couch gag.
Oh, wait, no, we have to do our intro. Okay, I'll do the beat.
Joe, you do the rap.
Roundabout.
That was great.
Well,
everyone just turned off their computer.
Good job, guys. So let's actually get into some talking about things, because we got a pretty stacked schedule today. We got a good diversity of things, and we got some lengthy talks to go through.
I'll say it's a lot of stuff that I'm really excited about, either stuff that I've experienced and I like, or stuff that I'm eager to know more about.
We're going to talk about something you know everything about, though, which is going to be Worm.
I guess that's the first.
Usually Worm is relegated to the back of our podcast as a second-class citizen, but I thought today we would open with it.
Mix it up a little bit.
So I've been sitting on these chapters for a little bit. I didn't get to read any last week. I've been mixing it up. You know how I do. I don't like to stick with one thing for too long, but I'll probably read some more this week.
Yeah, I kind of juggle different stuff, games, movies, whatever.
I'm a big juggler. While Bradley is like a very committed knight, he will stick to one thing.
Yeah, I'll have like two things tops, and then once I finish one of those, I'll swap something out. And then there's like maybe a few things that are just constants.
Yeah,
I do whatever the hell I want.
Yeah, Joe's somewhere in between.
So, yeah, Joe's just going with the wind. It's probably a good way to be.
With Worm, I read 10.6 and the 10 interlude, which puts me at 11, which is where Bradley has been really excited for me to get. So I'm pretty excited for that.
Yeah, it's the start of an interesting area in the story. But tell us what you think about 10.6 and Arc 10's big interlude.
So with 10.6, I remember I thought I read that last time, and you were really excited that I did, because it's one of your favorite chapters. Turns out I didn't actually read it. I was a big liar. But
yeah, I think we got 10.5 and 10.6 confused.
Which I quite like 10.5.
Oh, yeah.
But 10.6, we're going to talk about that. There's a fight in the beginning of it. It's not too long. It's not too interesting. I think they're just finishing up the escape with Dragon. Where we left off, if I remember correctly, Bitch did the thing where she threw Taylor into the foam. Which, that made that chapter for me. That was a really good twist.
Oh, yeah. That's a really good thing. And you mentioned this kind of short fight at the beginning of 10.6. And I think it's a little bit weird, because the end of 10.5 with the whole Rachel knocking Taylor into the foam, you know, that's excellent. And then we get the excellent stuff in 10.6, but the beginning of 10.6 kind of has like a really short few paragraph fight.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of felt like a weird break in the pace. I was like, it's kind of sandwiched between these two amazing character moments.
I actually thought the same thing, which I wasn't too big on this particular little fighting segment, which isn't anything too new for me, but
yeah, it's rare for me to not love something in Worm. That one little fight, I was like, I don't know if we really need that there.
Yeah, but it wasn't too long, so it wasn't that bad, because then we get this moment of just, I wrote in my notes, Taylor a psycho, because she gets back to Bitch and she just immediately gets really aggressive with her, which is not the first time she's done this.
Yeah, just this intense retaliation the moment she can get away with it.
It's amazing that she's still alive after being so aggressive and violent to, I think that's the second time, right, where she's just straight up really physically assaulted Bitch.
Yeah, this is almost like, almost an exact repeat of the first time they met
It's
when
fair.
Bitch did a similar thing. She attacked Taylor, and Taylor's like, don't fucking do that. I don't like that.
That's my no-no zone. But you know what? She has some good motivations. And I wrote down that she always has these weird deals with Bitch where she's like, she sets some weird conditional with her to make it so that they're not fighting anymore, basically. One of them was she would go check up on the dogs with her. I remember that. And this most recent one is just like, to get the group back together, she's like, I'm going to be your teammate and you can be salty about this or whatever, but we're not going to do this right now. We're just going to keep going. That's how it went, right? Because it's been a while since I read it.
And she's kind of like, she's like, I'm going to be in more situations where you can do that again, where you're going to have a chance to fuck me over. And that's just because of the nature of what we do. Like, so she's like, I'm pretty much going to trust you because I have to, because there's no other way we can operate. And she kind of punctuates this by like insisting, like, if you will let me, I will be your friend. And, you know, the very first time I read this many years ago, I was like, okay, that's kind of weird because, you know, it's like, why, right? Because she just tried to kill you and you just retaliated.
She always has these little deals and what's the word? These compromises with Bitch that always feel kind of like inorganic, but it's just, she's done this multiple times, so I guess that's just how she deals with Bitch. It always takes me out a little bit. But
the first time I read it, I always thought it was weird. But I get it now. I'll shit on Taylor a lot because just kind of the nature of the story is her being able to be convinced by herself or others to do these horrible things. But the points I will give her is that if she's convinced something is the right thing to do, she will do it, and like her mind is not going to be changed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that in her already.
Of course, you know, it's easy to convince her that something horrible might be the right thing to do. But there was a point in the past where she kind of resolved that being Bitch's friend is one of these kind of moral obligations she has. I think it was around the time she found out that Bitch's power kind of ruined her ability to form friendships or read people. Yes. And Taylor's like, okay, I know what it's like to be lonely. And she's like, if I'm not her friend, she's kind of relegated to a really lonely existence, is her word. So she resolved that she wants to be Rachel's friend. And once she decides on a course of action, there's no changing her mind. So
very stubborn.
Yeah, so, you know, that's kind of something I got out of a reread. I was like, okay, now I can kind of understand where she's coming from.
Mm-hmm. It does fit what we've seen of her so far. It's always a little jarring. Moving on, we get the scene with Coil. And Jesus, that guy is so slimy and disgusting.
God, he's a creep. And even like, if Taylor is freaked out by stuff Coil does, you know it's bad. Like, she's like, whenever he calls Dinah his pet, Taylor's like, Jesus Christ, that's so gross.
That's the one that really got to me. He has like, he's like petting her and calling her his pet, and she's on drugs all the time, right? And like, it's just so fucked up, and these people are just watching it, and they're like, yeah, this is fine.
Yeah, and you know, it makes sense that Taylor's disturbed by it. Like, I mean, any reasonable person would be. But, you know, that's her thing now. I think she even says it at the end of 10.6. She's like, I'm going to do, like, no matter what it takes, I'm going to save this girl. Like, that is her priority.
Mm-hmm. And it's really hitting home for me now that these guys are real. They're starting to become real villains, which I'm going to talk about in the next little section I read, especially. Where at first I didn't really feel it. Where they were like, okay, they're doing crime, but I don't feel like they're villainous. And now they each got their own territory, and they're working with this person who is clearly a scumbag. And I think I was asking you about it. I know why Taylor is working with Coil, but the rest of the crew is just working with them because it's monetary gain, right? Like, it's positive for them. And And
So all these
Tattletale
different.
kind of knows, like she knows what Taylor is up to, right? But like everyone else is just kind of doing it.
Yeah, so like they all have their own little personal reasons that they're also working with him. And that kind of thing where it starts hitting home that these people are actual villains, that's kind of what happens, I think, either at the end of Arc 7 or beginning of Arc 8, where, Taylor's kind of gone on this journey with them and she's like, oh, well, they're bad guys, but they're not bad guys. And then once they learned about Dinah, Taylor's like, okay, so that's the next thing we're doing, right? We're saving her. And they're like, no, why would we do that? And she's like, what are you talking about? And they're like, well, we don't know her. And she's like, he's our boss. And
Yeah, it goes
it's like,
directly against like what benefits them.
yeah, because, if Taylor wants to take down Coyle or save Dinah, they're like, Gru's like, well, he's giving me money so I can take care of my sister. And Rachel's like, well, he's giving me money so I can take care of my dogs. So they don't really have an incentive to help her.
That's all I'm gonna say for 10.6, so we
Yeah.
can move on with the
To the
schedule.
big boy.
It introduces the slaughterhouse stuff, which I don't feel one way or the other right now, but
I'll say we haven't got really a ton of info out of them. They just kind of give vague descriptions. I think the only line that I would point out about them is like, well, I mean, we get like the little plot drop that Dinah predicts they're going to end the world, but that's not what I wanted to focus on.
I really like that, by the way, that actually did pique my
Yeah, it's
interest.
just kind of like a casual, huge stakes increase that they kind of brush off just because they have other priorities right now. But the thing I really wanted to focus on is we don't know anything about them really, but there's one particular line that we can kind of derive how we're supposed to feel about them, where Coyle says, I want info on the Slaughterhouse Nine. And Taylor kind of stops and she's like, okay. If he's thinking about hiring them, that's a terrible idea. And the reason I like this is because virtually every villain we've seen so far in the story, they do what they do for very like pragmatic reasons. It's usually for money, territory, property, stuff like that, like immediately useful things. But this statement kind of shows that whoever these people are that villains are afraid of, whoever they are, whatever it is they do, it is not for money. Like, you're not going to be able to buy them.
They're clearly either insane or they got other things going on, which I'm sure we'll explore later.
Yeah. So, anyway, the big boy, the one we're really excited to talk about, is
10
Alexander.
interlude. So it was really good to see that scene of Alex, or not Alex, Alec, letting Shadowstalker, what's her, Sophia,
Yeah.
letting her go from his perspective. It was an immediate like, oh shit, this is about to get really fucked up.
Yeah, like at this point in the story, the first sentence of that chapter is probably the best chapter opening.
Oh yeah,
Like it's the second you read it, you're like, "Oh, I know what we're doing
it
here."
starts with I'm going to let you go, Alec lied. I was like, oh
Oh
fuck.
shit, here we go.
That really paints that whole scene different, and it just all goes downhill from here. I totally understand where he's coming from. We get a little bit of his past. I get why he's so messed up, but he's an incredible asshole. Like,
Oh yeah, like I don't, it's kind of weird because we would like to be able to sympathize with all the characters, especially when we get their backgrounds, but I think he's a particularly controversial character. There's a lot of people arguing about whether we should consider him an asshole or whether his past actions are forgivable.
I'm gonna burn
And
some
I'm not going to
bridges
state my
here.
stance. I'm not going to state my stance on that.
Oh,
People will argue all day.
I'm gonna burn some bridges here and say he is not to be forgiven. He is totally at fault. A lot of people go through hardship. The things he does are so vile, dude. He literally, consider this, he rapes people so he can fuck himself. And if Joe's listening, he's like, what the fuck did you
Yeah.
just say? This is a guy who can take people over and he can fully control their body. And this chapter delves into why he does it, how he feels about it. By the way, this is one of our protagonists.
Yeah. It's really weird because, he's a main cast member, and he's definitely the most monstrous character we've had as our point of view.
Yes.
But I think the chapter still kind of manages to be compelling, even if we don't sympathize with him.
Oh, totally, because he's a piece of shit, but so is Walter White, so is Griffith, but that doesn't mean they're not interesting characters. And I'm just gonna say that Alec is now, like, it kind of fucks me up to think about it. Like, I don't like to think about the things he does, but he's probably my favorite character now. 'Cause he's just so fascinating, and it's really unnerving 'cause he's such a leech, but it makes him really interesting. And I talked to you about this. Like, this guy is a sociopath. Like, he feels annoyed that he doesn't feel emotions more than he actually feels. Like, it's so unnerving to see a sociopath from that point of view, but then also how his powers really feed into him being a sociopath. It's
Yeah, if I hear the word sociopath, this is the character that comes into my head. Like, I can't think of a character that more embodies that word.
and just to go so this is one of those moments, like, I've been lukewarm on a lot of character stuff in Worms so far, but like, if there's more of like this level of power melding with the character, melding with like their mindset, and getting us into their mindset and understanding how they are and why they are the way they are and how they use their powers and why they use their powers. If it keeps going in this direction, I'm gonna enjoy a lot of the other characters we run into as well.
Yeah, because I think you said to me at one point that like the only reason that we get this chat, like the only reason we get the premise for this chapter and the way it plays out is because his power is what it is.
Yeah, and it really paints a picture of exactly how he feels. Like, he talks through his captive, and he feels what she feels. It's really weird. And just talking about the plot, which is like, the plot is my favorite part of Worm, and just the way the story unfolds, the way he gets back at Sophia for what she's done to Taylor, and just the scene in the house, that
Like you
shit.
kind of have to ask yourself, we've been from the perspective of Sophia's victim, Taylor, so we know how Taylor feels about it, but you still kind of have to ask yourself, is this overboard?
Right, that's what this chapter leaves you with, a really bitter, mixed feeling, though, because it's like, man, this girl, and we've seen her multiple times, not just with Taylor, she's just a bad person. She's also one of the more interesting characters. Like, she's probably top three for me as far as like interesting characters. It just so happens that all the interesting characters in the show are kind of assholes.
Yeah, and that might just be kind of the nature of the story itself.
Might be. We'll see how that unfolds. But this chapter definitely gets a 5 out of 5 for me. I think it's my first one.
Yeah, it's very fun. And whenever you read it, I went back to look at the comments on the chapter, and kind of the overwhelming response was like, man, I'm not going to say I agree with what he did, but it was also kind of satisfying to see that happen
I
to
read
her.
those too. I think people were a lot more positive than I was. But like, I was still intrigued either way, and I'd give 10.6 a 4 out of 5.
All right.
I really like the stuff with Coil.
So,
So hey, act two, or arc two rather, of Worm is definitely, enjoying it a lot more than arc one.
yeah, I guess like the part one, book one of Worm kind of ended with the Leviathan arc, and we're kind of moving into the more, I guess like the bigger meat of the story. And I just realized I said bigger meat, which is kind of hilarious to me,
Ayo.
if you're me.
Only if you're
So yeah,
you.
I don't know. We'll see where Willer goes and see what he likes.
All right, I'm very excited about this next part.
I'm also excited.
We have got One Piece. Bradley finished Arlong Park and got
Hey,
into Loon's Town a
Bisu.
little bit.
Yeah.
Bradley, talk to us. You took some notes to guide us
Oh.
along.
Oh, you know I took notes.
Hell yeah.
So, where we left off last week, for all of our three listeners out there.
We love y'all.
Yeah, hey Jamal, thinking about you.
Hey, actually, people seem to like the One Piece talk last week.
Yeah. Well, I mean, how could you not? So, where we left off last week was our crew kind of had their big rendezvous, and Luffy busted into Arlong Park, and he's like, which one of you guys is Arlong? So, we're getting into the fight that
The
we've been
action,
building up.
yes.
Yeah, we've spent probably 20 to 30 chapters kind of having an amazing build up, by the way, to this
Yes.
fight that we're finally about to jump into. And much like can be expected of One Piece, the fighting is not just fighting, it is also character development, and we have some good stuff to say about it.
Hell yeah, in One Piece, it's all build up, but then the fight itself is a storytelling, and especially like some of the recent fights to tell really beautiful stories, and that's just always been a One Piece thing.
All right. So I can just kind of go chronologically with my notes as we head into this. I might try to give like a little play-by-play just so people know where we are, what we're talking about. Luffy goes in. Arlong's okay. Who the hell are you? Blah, blah, blah. Luffy takes out some of the littler fishmen that we don't care about. And we are left with Arlong and his three officers. And it's kind of funny how Luffy removes himself from the battle temporarily.
Yes. He always finds a way.
Yeah, he like we have to like sometimes we kind of have to find a way to remove Luffy temporarily from the fight. And I had talked about this back during, I think, Usopp's
Yes.
introductory arc. And we find really entertaining ways to do that where Luffy does this really cool attack. But in order to do it, he anchors himself by burying his foot in the ground.
Which is really
And
dumb
then
because
he can't get back
he
out.
could easily crack the ground with his fist, but what a, it's fine.
Yeah, I mean, like I don't really care about that.
It's all
So
gags anyways.
yeah, and so he gets stuck in the ground. Arlong throws him in the water, and then we move on to kind of our three. I was about to say side fights, but I wouldn't even call them side fights. They are like my favorite parts of the arc.
And they get a
It
lot of focus too.
yeah. To me, they feel like the fights you get right before the UFC like title bout or main event kind of deal.
Sure.
They're still really good. It's just like
They're
not
the WrestleMania fights leading up to the championship belt at the end or whatever.
Yeah.
So, me being unwise Bradley, going into these three fights where it's the officers versus Zoro, Sanji, and Usopp, I was like, okay, I'm excited, but I really hope this doesn't end up kind of being like Pearl, where we're just kind of fluffing out the arc a little bit, and I don't care about the fight. Fortunately, it ended up being awesome, and here's why. Well, there's actually a lot of reasons why. That's the majority of my notes. So, one thing I'd like to touch on every episode is kind of Oda's philosophy that he's stated, I think, more than once, where in One Piece, it's less about killing the bad guy and more about challenging and shattering their worldview. And I think I got to talk a lot about that with Krieg last week. But I'm really excited about it here. So Arlong's kind of big philosophy that we want to challenge this arc is that humans are inferior, fishmen are the superior beings. And I think what challenges is that the most is these three fights. At the end of last week, I was like, oh, I would kind of like,
Nami
I'd
to
kind
get
of
the
like
final
a,
hit or whatever.
yeah, I was like, I kind of want like a normal human, not necessarily a rubber man, to get the spotlight. And Luffy does end up finishing off Arlong, but I'm regard like that doesn't even matter. Like I'm extremely satisfied with what we got because what we see are three normal ass humans defeat his three strongest officers, especially Usopp, who
Man, Usopp's
we're
fight's so
gonna.
good.
Oh my God, yeah, I have a few paragraphs on that. So I feel like Oda's really sticking true to his philosophy, where it's like we need to destroy what this guy's all about. We're gonna give him solid proof that no, these humans are kicking your superior fishman's ass. So chew on that, Arlong. So let's see. Blah, blah, blah. They start fighting. Talked about that. Okay. So I don't have as much to say about Zoro and Sanji's fights as I do about Usopp's. They're very great. We kind of see Zoro stick to his resolve not to lose to anybody until he fights Mihawk again. These are just, it's just genuinely good action.
I'll talk a little bit about these
Yeah, go for it.
to fill for you. So Zoro's fight, he gets to fight Hachi, which Hachi's the one redeemable person in that crew. Like you can tell he's kind of a goofball.
Yeah, he's kind of funny.
And knowing some stuff from later, like he's not the worst of the crew. He's all
He's
right.
very hospitable. Like Zoro comes up and he's really just like, yeah, oh yeah, okay, and just like does everything to make Zoro happy and
Which
whatever.
results into Zoro killing his crew, which is, man, I could see why he'd be angry.
Yeah.
Just the idea of an octopus man with six swords and being able to stick to walls just gives that fight like a nice flow to it. It's the most straightforward fight, but like you said, Zoro vowed last arc to never lose again because that is the only thing that would be fitting for a pirate king. And he's really sticking to it this arc, where he's bleeding, he's getting headbutted, his wounds are opening up. Injuries in One Piece, these characters are really tough, but the injuries from previous arcs do show up in current arcs, and they have that kind of relationship where like Zoro is nerfed this arc because he took such a beating last arc, and he has to work through it. And you get that awesome scene where Johnny and Yusaku throw him his swords, and he does streaming wolf swords through Hachan's like six
Man,
swords, and it's just such a cool scene and such a cool attack.
is very cool.
Very cool. And then for Sanji's fight, I think that's my favorite fight of the three, possibly. It's up there with Usopp because he has an ulterior goal, which gives the fight a little bit of spice. He jumps into the water knowing that he's outmatched, right? But it's the only way that he can free Luffy. Which the thing they do with Luffy, where they have to stretch his head up through the water, really fun way to solve that. Also shows you that while underwater, Paramecia type devil fruits, they still keep their weird bodies. They just don't have any control or power to actually
They're
move.
like comatose or rendered useless.
Yeah,
Yeah. That was
so.
kind of wild because whenever Luffy initially got thrown into the water, I was like, oh my God, how are they gonna have him not die? But the solution was such like a simple and obvious thing. And but it's still so cool at the same time.
Well, and it kind of just shows for Luffy, like it's like he is made out of rubber. Like that doesn't change regardless. Like he's it's not like an ability he activates. He is just like a rubber
He is
man.
a rubber man.
Yeah. Oh.
And then for Sanji's fight also, they're both fighting with kind of karate-esque moves. It introduces Fishman Karate, which will come back later.
Way later.
I really like the thing where he takes Sanji all the way down and then they go all the way back up and Sanji breathes into his gills so he can get a
Yeah.
breath of air and finish him off on land. It's really like the flow of that fight. He swims back down, he frees Luffy. But that's what I got for those.
Yeah, and so I wanted to give Usopp a special spotlight, which I never thought I would say.
Hey.
Like it's been no secret that since his introduction of like kind of the main five, I've considered him the weaker character in the cast. Like I love him as comic relief, and I don't list dislike him at all. But up till now, I felt like he didn't necessarily have the depth that
Okay,
our other guys
I was about to
did.
say what you meant by weaker, like
Yeah.
physically or because
Well,
he's physically supposed to be weaker, but
yeah.
he's
No.
Bradley th saw him as the weakest in both regards.
Yeah. But oh man, after this fight, holy shit.
Holy shit.
So he fights Fish
Chew.
Hisoka. I don't remember the guy's actual name, but
His
he
name
looks
is
like
Chew.
yeah, he looks like Hisoka with fish
He
lips.
really doesn't, but okay.
No, dude, I'm sticking by it.
Sure.
He th like this fight of this is one of the one moments in One Piece so far that's just the most like alarm like wee woo character development's happening right now. Like oh my God. So up till now Usopp has always kind of battled on a formula like through a flow chart where it's like first try to intimidate the enemy with a bluff. If it
Yes.
works, which it pretty much never does, then good for you. When the bluff fails, you try and attack. If the attack fails, which it usually does, you run or you play dead. And I mean, technically, this has worked out for him. I mean, it's made Usopp survive up until now, but you know, he's not gonna get the big wins using these techniques.
Right.
It is still useful, though, to the team, especially here, because what's useful about this technique is that it stalled for time. Like, if Usopp wasn't there, Zoro and Sanji would be fighting three guys instead of just two.
Yes. And there's a point where Usopp is like he's willing to give up the fight because he's like, well, Luffy and Zoro and Sanji will take care of it, you know? So he's very aware that he could be sending Chu to go gang up on the others, and for a moment he's okay with it.
Yeah, and he kind of has to overcome that, right? Because when it gets to the point where he kind of does his ketchup packets to make himself look
So
bad,
good.
he's lying there on the ground, and Chu starts walking away, and he starts getting these flashbacks of things that other characters have said. Like, he remembers Zoro saying that he would actually rather die than be defeated or just conceding this fight. And he remembers Nami having the resolve to stab herself instead of Usopp. And he remembers these dozens of townspeople who are all probably even weaker than Usopp coming to Arlong Park to fight, even though they're all well aware
They're gonna
that they will
die.
probably die.
Yeah.
But they resolve to do it anyway because they would rather die than not do this fight for Nami's sake. And so after he remembers these things, he gets this brief moment of just like overwhelming shame that he hasn't had the same resolve for his friends that they've had for him. And we just get like this, just like fire in his heart. And he's like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm gonna fight this guy to the finish, even if it kills me. He gets that same attitude that Zoro has, that all these other people has. And you know what? He ends up fucking winning.
It's beautiful, dude. He becomes a straw hat in that moment for real.
Crazy. And like, Oda has a really good mind for when to play the comic relief card and when to be emotionally serious. I feel like a lot of other writers would have been tempted to have Usopp make that great character realization and then have him be struck down immediately because this is funny. But Oda realized that, you know, in this moment, this is where we needed to take Usopp.
He needed a moment of bravery. And I really like how he gets up and he starts yelling at Chu to piss him off. Like he's not even kind of coy about it. He calls him like freaky fish lips or some shit. Like even
He does. And boy, does that boy have lips.
they're both lippy boys, so it's a good matchup.
Lippy boys.
Solid DSL fighting going on
Big
there.
DSL fish fight.
God.
So another good part of the fight is how Usopp decides to take the fight at that point with the bluff, with the oil, and he sets him on fire, and he just gets a fucking hammer, and he just goes to town.
Yeah, and I like it because I think Usopp after this fight kind of has a new niche where it's not that same flowchart anymore. It's, you know, he's still kind of that trickster kind of battle
Fighter.
style, but it's more aggressive.
Aggressive trickster.
Yeah, and I like it a lot. I'm just really proud of my boy, especially because after he wins, he runs back to where everyone else is and he's like, guys, 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 I did it, I did it. I beat one of Arlong's officers all by myself. And at that moment, I really wanted to be in the story with him. Like, no, guys, he actually really did it. Be proud of him. I wanted to be
They
there.
kind of brush him off like it's expected for you to do it, dude. You're a straw hat. You had to do that.
It's your job.
But I'm really proud of my boy. I like him a
I
lot.
also I think this is the introduction of Usopp Rubber Band.
Oh my God,
What
Rubber
a good
Band Doom.
move.
The ultimate move.
Wow, man. He's got such a fun move set.
And it's funny because like he'll pull out the rubber band and he doesn't even fire it, and then these people who turn villages upside down are like flinching, like, no, please.
Such a strong
Oh.
move. It's huge.
It's a great gag.
It's a zero damage but very good combo starter.
Yeah.
I also like Chu, like just the power of his shots. There's that panel of him just peppering the forest and the trees with
Oh
all these
man.
really strong water bullets, and it just looks really cool.
That's the thing. It always goes without saying that, like, Just God, the art and the motion in One Piece is phenomenal. Like, even if there was an arc that I didn't like the story or characters at all, I would probably still enjoy reading it just because the art is amazing. So.
People say that One Piece art is bad. I think they're mostly looking at anime, which it just doesn't translate when Toei does it a lot of the times, but I think it's more fair to say that Oda's art style is weird, but his actual ability to draw is incredible. His backgrounds, the way he does impact and motion. Bradley's been
He,
sending him some screenshots, sending us some screenshots of like
yeah,
particularly really good panels.
he's a very. It's funny that you say that they did judge off just based off the anime because his panels all have like an animation flow to them. Like they are designed for you to like see every like to go through everything very quickly, more or less. Like you're supposed to like. A flip book or like you're really kind of connecting all those like panels and pages together as like one flowing motion.
The way he does flow is incredible. He's a genius.
I've never seen anyone who like can portray motion on a still 2D image as well as Oda can.
And he also just makes the act of reading a manga just enjoyable. The way he lays out his panels, the pacing, the flow. It's
And
just
the page turn,
the
man.
page turns. You page turn into
Master of the
Luffy
page
punching the
turn.
shit out of Arlong. So
Yeah.
good.
That was something I severely missed when I was reading Bakuman, was that it just doesn't stand up to One Piece when it comes to like that reading flow. Like it they're sometimes like extremely like blocked out, but like that never happens in One Piece, I feel.
Yeah, I mean, Oda might be the best at the technical part of manga.
He's a master of the craft.
It just also happens that he's the best at the writing part as well. A.
Okay.
So Bradley, what do we got next point-wise?
So after we kind of conclude our fights with the officers, or as the fights are wrapping up, Arlong presents Nami with kind of a crossroads. She really wants, he's like, here's the thing. I'm gonna kill Zoro and Sanji no matter what. They hurt my officers, they have to die. Like, I'm sorry. Sorry, not sorry. But she kind of gives He kind of gives Nami a choice. He's like, you can either just stop now, come work for me. I'll let all the villagers live. You'll never want for anything. You know, everything goes back to how it was. Or you guys can keep fighting, try to save your friends, and I'll kill everybody. And this is a really tough call. And I kind of sat here for a while thinking about what the morally right choice is, which there's no way to really do that. But that's part of what makes this moment great. Like, she can't just let Zoro and Sanji die after they risked everything for her. But the alternative is going back to the same routine she's been doing for 8 years. She has been working for a monster. The village people are extorted or killed, and it's a tough call, but she decides that she's just gonna fight and the village people are gonna fight with her. Not the band, the people from
Doesn't she say, "I'm sorry, everyone," as she makes the
Yeah,
decision?
she's like, I'm sorry, but you're just gonna have to fight with me. Because I think she finally realized that working for Arlong the past 8 years has accomplished nothing for anybody.
Yeah, no,
If any.
because if she gets back in this loop, there's a very, very, very high chance he's just gonna find some other way to dick her near like when she reaches her goal again.
Yeah, it's like a kind of a recurring thing in this arc is this attitude towards what they have, like their duty. Much like Zoro and Usopp, she reaches this point where she's like, honestly, dying would be preferable to just conceding at this point. She's like, I'm just gonna fight you with all I got. And, you know, these past 8 years, she didn't know this, but she now knows that all the villagers are in this with her. They all came there on their own behalf to potentially die for her. So she's like, you know what? If you want to, I'll let you. Like, for so long, she just carried like the burden of everybody on her back. And
Yeah.
that's really noble of her, but the village wants to return the favor. So, like, on one hand, someone might interpret it as selfish to let the villagers die when she could save them all instead, but I still view this as like a huge growth for Nami. She finally accepted that it's okay to get help. And you know, she accepted that earlier when she asked Luffy for help, but I think this
Reinforces it.
moment is cementing that, you know, this is who Nami is now.
This it's really also opening up to like it's okay to to have people that you actively rely on and trust. Because that was Nami's big thing, was that she couldn't trust Zoro and she couldn't like keep ties, or Zoro with Luffy in the gang, and just couldn't keep ties with anybody. Like this is the arc where she learns that like there are people out there that I can legitimately trust and know that they will take care of me and help me, and she goes through that character
And
growth.
there's one more layer to this, and it's the fact that it shows that even though she distanced herself from the town, she was never alone in those 8 years.
Oh
They
man, my heart.
always loved her, they always cared for her, and they were always on her side, even as she was doing like these bad, atrocious things aligning with the pirates. And
It's crazy.
it's just really good, and they're all on the same page now. They're all gonna go die together, yeah.
It's just a man, like Nami and Usopp are two characters that just came out of Arlong Park, just changed on a fundamental level.
Oh yeah.
And it's amazing. So let's see. Nami resolves to fight. They end up we end up getting Luffy back. And so for my next like big note, it's gonna sound like I'm going off on a tangent, but I promise this is relevant.
No.
I realize that this structure we kind of have in Arlong Park, and I'm sure future One Piece arcs, and it reminds me of the structure of the Saiyan saga of Dragon Ball Z. If you'll forgive me for comparing the mighty One Piece to Dragon Ball Z.
I mean, it's Dragon Ball Z is One Piece's biggest influence, so go for it.
So, like our main boy, Luffy slash Goku, you know, they get taken out early, and our other members of the cast spend the majority of the arc fighting on like the little henchmen in one-on-one battles. And these battles don't feel wasted or like filler because they each kind of get their own little special moment to shine. And our baddies are surprised that these inferior beings are putting up such a good fight. But while our, you know, while the kind of little lesser, the weaker guys are doing better than expected, they know that they're ultimately going to be no match for Arlong or Vegeta. The end goal here is to survive long enough to get Luffy or Goku to recover and get back in the battle. And there's a reason I find this structure really interesting. It's kind of like, you know, up to that point in the Dragon Ball series, you know, it's always been about Goku. He's our hero. He's going to save the day. And like 90% of the action up to then was just always Goku wrecking people in Dragon Ball. In the Saiyan saga, he still gets to be the big cheese. He still gets to be the one who saves everybody, but we're treating everything differently. Rather than all the action focusing on him, the majority of the action is on the characters who wouldn't normally get the spotlight. They're the ones who would normally be on the sidelines cheering Goku on, and that's in fact what most of them did in Dragon Ball. So we get to focus on our other people, our main cast members, without taking away that position of power that Goku has. And you know, he still gets the climax of the arc. He gets the big battle at the end. And it's kind of the same thing here. You know, we don't always want One Piece to just be Luffy fucks everyone up and his friends cheer on the sideline. And fortunately, that's not what One Piece is at all. The fights that Luffy and his friends get are just as important, or more important even, than like the big climactic fight.
For sure. And it eventually evolves beyond that, where it's like Luffy, his role is the captain slash problem solver, right? He's the big muscle. But in a lot of future arcs, it
He's
starts
the ace in
becoming
the hole.
like other crew members are making really important plays. They're not necessarily focal fights, but they're doing such important things or getting such important character development where it's like, yeah, everyone's getting some love.
Yeah, like the best way I can describe it to bring it down to the measly level of like a football game, because everyone here loves sports.
Everyone
But
here loves
since
football. Yo, football's awesome.
Yo, football's the
No,
shit.
American football.
Oh yeah. Ew.
No,
Yeah,
that's the one I'm talking. What do you?
it's great
Just
all
because
over.
I'm Brazilian doesn't mean I mean football,
Yeah, no, but
okay?
essentially, like, you know, Luffy, you can describe Luffy as like the star quarterback or running back, the one that like makes those big plays and everyone cheers for. But really, like, Luffy would never like kind of be set up in those situations without the rest of his crew members.
Yeah.
Without his linemen, you know?
Yeah,
Yeah,
they're the
you like
offensive line, and Zoro's like the quarterback, if anything.
Yeah,
How far
and
we
or
stretch this
like
analogy?
having a running back, or just in general, like they each have their own part and they're very important to like the overall goal of what the team, what the crew is trying to do, that island or arc or whatever of what's happening.
To the point where, like, even if a character is not getting a fight that arc, they are getting something if they're in that arc. They are going to get their moment. And
yeah,
it really helps them all seem worth it, even if they're, like, they're not as strong as Luffy, but they all have their role to play.
Yeah, we didn't have any cheerleaders. You know, everybody played a part in making this happen.
Yeah.
Everyone, like, there's a crew member that comes in later. And Willer, you know who I'm talking about.
Jesus, the ultimate MVP.
Yeah, who like literally went on, like, who just pulled it like a hat trick over everybody, and like essentially like made this whole what would have been like a essentially for the crew like this huge like roadblock or like
impossible task that they needed to do.
Yeah, or something they would have to like eventually come back to do, and he did it, and you're like, oh my god, oh. Like, the relief you feel after that is amazing.
And it's not even, like, there's combat involved, but it's not even, like, a combat task. It's just, like, oh my god, you clutched so hard.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you look forward to the Straw Hats being great characters and being useful.
That's one thing I really like about One Piece, and I think Oda has figured that out, is that you can have your side characters that aren't, like, physically not physically, they're all like pretty physically strong, but in terms of like not being as strong as Luffy or not being your key, like your star player, and have them something that's really meaningful and impactful to do that's still very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And really kind of attaches you to them and really appreciates it whenever someone else is going to do something. And you're like, okay, I'm on board. Let's do it. And it makes that part just more engaging to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. I think we can move on to the next point if we're ready for it.
Please, Bradley. I've been born ready.
All right. So we now have Luffy versus Arlong.
Yeah.
God, this action. Holy shit. It's amazing. This fight is also where, in the entirety of the 30 or so chapters that comprise Arlong Park, this is where we actually get the majority of Arlong's dialogue.
It's true.
And man, I actually really like his dialogue.
Arlong is a cool villain, man.
Yeah. I'm gonna make a comparison that's gonna sound really weird here for a minute.
Here we go.
But just bear with me here.
No.
certain facets of Arlong's philosophy vaguely remind me of my favorite JoJo's antagonist, Yoshikage Kira.
Really?
Yeah, you hear me out here.
Okay, let's go. Let's do it.
These guys are both total monsters. Okay, they do these horrible things. Mm-hmm. But I don't think either of them actually really believe they're doing anything wrong. The thing is, Arlong, he it's not even just him being an asshole. He just genuinely does not view humans as people. If that makes sense.
Dude, like, you're super right, and you don't know how right you are until later.
Way later.
Because Arlong, he clearly is not incapable of feeling empathy. Like, he feels great empathy for his guys. Whenever he's genuinely upset that his, and I quote, beloved comrades were slain by these people he views as nothing.
I love that line. That I remember reading through that and be like, God, man,
yeah,
that
when
is
he said beloved comrades, I'm like, whoa, we're not just dealing with a generic asshole here.
He's not some guy that would, you know, the worst kind of villain is the one who shoots his underling because like a Morgan, you know, that's what Morgan would do.
Yeah, because like whenever he said that line, I realized that up till now, we've pretty much only seen Arlong in the context of treating humans like shit. But then you realize that these fishmen have been with him for decades, and he probably loves them. And to him, they aren't disposable creatures like humans are. Mm-hmm. And like he really makes it clear how horrible of an act he thinks humans killing fishmen are.
Oh my god.
But much like Kira, he just has this warped view of the world where he has his own sense of justice, and to him, he's like, how can you guys not see that you're being the assholes? He's like, just leave me alone and let me fuck up these humans. Like, he just doesn't understand why they don't see things the way he does. And he even like check stuff off on a list. He's like, no, like, you're inherently inferior. You can't breathe underwater. I'm stronger than you. Like, in his mind, this
you don't
is
got
just
a thick nose. You can't take your teeth out and regrow them.
I really like that part of the fight where he's just showing like all these cool techniques that he can do to prove a point. He's like, you can't throw water like a bullet. Look at me with my cool teeth claws. You can't like bite down through this thing. Like, he's showing himself to be on paper superior.
Yeah, like, yeah. And we take it even further. Because, you know, Arlong takes his teeth out for his little hand teeth attack. And Luffy uses a fish man as a shield. And Arlong gets really upset. And it's not like, how dare you defy me? How dare you not die when I'm trying to kill you? It's how dare you make one of my fishmen get hurt by my own attack? Like, he's just so mad. Like, so whenever he's saying this stuff about how fishmen are superior, that's not just villain taunting. That's not coming from a position of arrogance. He truly believes it.
Dude, and you're making me realize that there's a lot to Arlong that I didn't quite piece together, but just know that like there is more depth to this that I think you're really gonna like.
Yeah, but it's about like 4 or 5 hot minutes away.
Yeah, like at least 5 hot minutes.
So you know, as I go through One Piece, I try to like, I really try to dissect everything I can out of it.
So
I don't know if like someone just like watching the anime would have gotten all this same stuff, or someone speed reading the manga. But mm-hmm. I don't know. Joe speed read, and he probably got all this. So
no, mm-hmm. Dude, you're doing great. This is the best analysis on YouTube. All 5 viewers know.
Confirmed.
What one thing about One Piece is that this is like the one like manga series or anything that. And it took me, oh god, when did it take me? It might have taken me until the Water 7 or just past Alabasta arc, where like it's just like, no, everything is put in there for a reason. That mm-hmm. everything, like they're like you want to like Oda doesn't just like do something just because he wants to or just is thinking in the moment. Like he specifically like phrases things and put things in certain places and says and drops certain names because they relate to something else in this world or adventure.
Which is cool because Bradley is going into this. So when I went into it, of course, I was a dumb kid. I went in watching 4Kids and I watched some AMVs and I bought some GameCube games and I eventually read the manga and I read it really fast and I had bad scanlations. So like when I went in the first time, you don't expect One Piece to be as deep as it gets.
No.
So,
yeah, like, you know, I finally started reading it because I hear you guys talk about it and it has all these elements I like. And, like, before I heard these things, in my mind, One Piece was always just like, oh, it's a 90s shonen. It's just, you know, punch hard. Yay, we won. Mm-hmm. Friendship. So, but it's so much more than that.
I mean, the first few, like, arcs are like that.
But even then, Bradley got so much out of them that is super valid. And that's the thing, right? I went in just... And I read it as that. I didn't see past that at the time. But on my recent reread, I've been slowly rereading it and going through it with Bradley and Joe. It's like, my God, he was really ahead of the time setting up these big things that will only pay off later.
Yeah, he knew what he was doing.
So in the end, my point here is that Bradley's going to get a really... fun enjoyment out of One Piece, the kind that I only get on a reread or something, or like reading discussions. Bradley's gonna get it on the first go because he's looking at it at that level.
Hey, yeah, that's something else that like I realized too, because I mentioned it with Mihawk. Like if I was reading this week to week and Mihawk showed up and just basically interrupted that arc, I like would have been just like not all about it, because I'm like, why is this random dude just showing up in the middle of this arc? This doesn't mean anything. And then he leaves. This is bullshit. But when I was... That was me thinking in the context of, like, him, if I was reading week to week or watching it, like, week to week. But then, like, from a bigger point of view, when I was reading it, and Mihawk shows up, and he like, nearly kills Zoro, and it's like, all right, I'll see you later, gang, and the 7 Warlords of the Seas is dropped. I'm just like, okay, this guy is fairly important, so he'll show up again later. I should keep that in mind. Because I knew the series is... I think at the time, like 930 chapters deep.
Yep. And so, there's all right.
No way he show up. And man, does he show up.
Yep. Bradley, what you got next? What we got?
Yeah, so that's kind of like the main thing I wanted to focus on as far as like dialogue
An
in the
hour
fight
long.
itself. Like holy shit, we get really cool moves, but like both Luffy and Arlong pull out amazing things here, like
Fingernet
Gum
and spear and shark darts and the
Jesus.
tooth attack, just fun stuff all
It's
around.
all really cool, like.
Arlong's sawtooth sword is one of my favorite weapons in any fiction. I think it looks so fucking rad.
Does look rad.
I really like the design of that weapon. And the
And
fact
like,
that he just punches into the building and gets it out, just rips it out of the building and starts fighting with it.
then like between them stretching Luffy's neck earlier and Gum Gum Fingernet and Gum Gum Shield, I'm like, okay, we're not even like we haven't even scratched the surface of everything that's possible with Luffy's abilities. Because the thing is, every time he does one of these things, in retrospect, it seems so obvious. Like, oh, of course he can do that. But I just, hadn't thought of it yet.
Yeah,
So,
that goes places.
very excited. So we kind of go forward. They're jumping around the building. They're cutting it up. We get to Nami's room that she basically slaved away in for 8 years.
Man.
And Luffy as soon as he knows what the room is, he knows what he has to do. And this kind of goes back to Luffy's emotional maturity and just deep understanding of his friends and what they need. Like, as soon as he knows what this room is, he's like, I have to destroy it. He's
Yep.
like, this place is not good for Nami.
Immediately, just like that.
And I was really worried because I was like, oh my God, like, what if Nami's like, oh God, I worked on this for 8 years. But as soon as she knows what he's doing, she cries and she's like, thank you. And every time I see Nami cry, I cry. So it's really
Like clockwork.
oh man. So God, that moment was really good. And then like a few pages later, we get the ending climax. We get the most powerful Gum Gum battle axe we've seen, and Jesus
Freaking
Christ destroys the entire
kicks through
building.
the whole building, and Arlong hits him with a freaking devastating attack with the spinning bite with like a jaw like Arlong. If that's coming at you and it gets Luffy in the side,
It's a
that
shark.
insane amount of pain, but he just powers through it, kicks him through the building. All of Arlong Park goes down.
And I was like, man, if that did not kill Arlong, then nothing will. And you know what? Well, I don't think it actually killed him, per
It did
se.
not. I will
But I was
say.
like, if that does not end this fight, then nothing will. So.
But like you said, One Piece fights are battles of will, and that he destroyed Arlong physically, destroyed his building that stands for oppression of the human race and his power. He just takes it all down with one attack. Beautiful.
And man, pretty soon after that, they go to celebrating, and I'm right there with them. I'm like, fuck yeah, like their lives have been
Party.
ruined by this guy forever. So I'm just very happy to see them all free. We get several moments throughout the party. Luffy and Zoro obviously have to be healed up. Usopp gets praised for killing the officer, or not killing, whatever, you know what I mean?
Murdering a man.
Yeah. Usopp gets praised for his role in the fight, and I was very happy. I was like, yeah, he deserves it. I mean, he kicked ass. And then we kind of get the background on oh my God, Nojiko getting the tattoo to make Nami feel better
So good.
about being forcibly tattooed was just such a sweet thing. And
Nojiko's
then
great.
pretty shortly after that, we see the reveal about Nami's new tattoo with the tangerine and the pinwheel. God, I think probably the most tears I've had so far is the reveal about Genzo, why he wears the pinwheel.
Oh, it's so sweet. He's
And
worried all this time for not because Nami used to like it as a kid, and it's just a symbol of their relationship. So good.
this is another technique that I love Oda for, because like One Piece just kind of has inherently goofy character designs sometimes. And throughout this entire arc, throughout Arlong Park, Luffy repeatedly talks about Genzo's pinwheel, like, hey, that's funny, I want one, like, blah, 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 blah. And, if he had never made, I always assumed it was just for comic relief, and it kind of is. If he hadn't repeatedly make those jokes, I probably wouldn't have noticed the pinwheel, just because everyone kind of has silly character designs.
Yeah.
But
yeah, same.
Because he repeatedly points that out, it's conscious in my mind. And then when we get to this point, I'm like, oh my god, that's why he has the iconic pinwheel.
The iconic
pinwheel. Iconic.
So, like, Oda is such a good technique at subtly keeping in your mind without going like, hey, this is going to be really important. So, man.
Oh, man. Man, I can't wait, Joe. I can't wait.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to get this 10 out of 10 analysis on every chapter, my man. So
fucking better.
It's good.
It's man, right. And keep it around for
that. That being said, Luffy freaking out about the pinwheel every time he sees it is still one of my favorite gags.
Oh, it's hilarious. So like, but as soon as Luffy didn't die from drowning, as soon as he's conscious again, he's like, hey, where's your pinwheel? And he's like, that is not important right now, Luffy. This is not what we're doing
and
right now.
Too is something I've realized with the Oda is that he interjects, like, he will have these moments of very long, not very long, but these kind of like exposition dumps, and he interjects these like little tiny bits of humor that don't feel too random, but are there to really break up the tension of the scene and help, you know, keep everything kind of a little bit happier and on the good side, and kind of remind you that that's a little fun adventure we're going on here. Don't worry about it. You know, we're just murdering everybody, and there's, you know,
don't think about the darkness. It's perfectly paced, and those exposition heavy chapters are 10 out of 10. So it's like,
yeah, Willer and I just got one last week. Oh man. That was some good shit.
Feed me more, Daddy Yoda, please.
Yeah.
All right, Bradley. Let's get the wrap up.
As far as wrapping up Arlong Park, you know, for stuff like the tattoo and the pinwheel, I talked about it. I didn't really take a lot of notes because the stuff I like to take notes on and analyze is the stuff that people wouldn't necessarily get if they were speed reading or if they didn't try to analyze what they read. But like the stuff with the pinwheel, no matter how fast you're going through, you're going to be like, oh my God, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. So like, I didn't feel the need to point out how amazing that is. It just is.
So, but I got to talk about it.
Anger tattoos is another great moment. Yeah. For me.
Would that be Nami's departure?
What do you mean?
Well, Joe said there was another great moment.
No, the part where Nami's having these flashbacks, and Nami is crying in the corner because she has to get a tattoo for Arlong's pirates, and then her sister, ends up getting her own tattoos to make her feel better. I'm like, oh.
And it just touches your heart.
My heart.
Yeah.
And then the last big moment we get after that, on the island is, you know, it's kind of weird because everyone's saying goodbye to the Straw Hats. Nami's not there yet, and everyone's like, oh, well, you know, it's like she's got to hurry up. You guys are about to leave. And she's like sprinting towards the boat. She's like, guys, start sailing. And they're like, what the fuck? And everyone's like, no, we want to say goodbye. And you have all these options running through your head. Like, okay, is there something dangerous chasing her? Like, does she just not want to say goodbye? Like, she's scared of goodbyes. And she jumps on the ship and you see all the wallets fall out and you're like, God damn it, Nami. and it's so good because it's so like her. And like, it kind of shows that we've had huge growth, but this is still going to be the same Nami that you know and love. And, you know, at first all the village people were like, hey, give me my wallet back. But, you know, they still love her. And they also kind of realize that she left them with 100 million berries. So they're like, okay, whatever.
I guess it's fair.
Yeah. So, and then they take off and man, Arlong Park was an easy 5 out of 5. Like,
yeah,
holy
boy.
Shit.
Yeah. Willer and I were like, there are some arcs in One Piece where Will and I will look at each other and be like, there's no way Bradley's not going to like this chapter, like this arc, like at all. Like, Arlong Park is one of those.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like every once in a while in manga, like that one, you know what it is, in Steel Ball Run, we'll talk to each other and just be like, there's no way that someone would give this less than a 5 out of 5. Like, it's just, no, it's too good.
101%.
So, and then I read one more chapter, which it's kind of like a step. I don't know if you'd call it a stepping stone chapter. It's just kind of like transitioning us from one arc to the next.
I think we call those ripple chapters because it was a bounty reveal, right? And then you get to see all the characters.
Yeah, I like that ripple because it's kind of showing the effect that Luffy's had on the world up till now.
Yes, those are some of the best chapters.
Yeah.
That one chapter where you were like, "Yo, I heard there was a big chapter in One Piece this week," because it was top of r slash all. That
One Piece
was
ripple
a ripple chapter.
chapter.
Yeah, and it's really fun. We just kind of get to step away and see how the rest of the world is impacted by our main cast.
Because the most beautiful part of One Piece and its world building is that the world is moving
At the same
alongside the
speed.
Straw Hats.
Yep.
Especially like with an event going on now in the current arc that we know that's happening while all the events of Straw Hat's happening, you're just like, what the fuck is gonna happen? But yeah.
So we get to see probably the most of the Navy we've seen up to this point. Luffy has a price on his head because that little douchebag mouse captain who was working with
Nezumi.
Arlong, he got his little feelings hurt. So he's like, you know what? Luffy's the most dangerous pirate in the world. So, or at least the East Blue. So, yeah, Luffy is a wanted man. Oh, yeah. And then our crew heads to Rogueport,
Yes.
where Gold Roger was both born and killed. And man, the city immediately looks cool. And I like that we're heading here because it's probably like a rite of passage. It's like a pilgrimage for Luffy. He's like,
Oh,
I
yeah.
have to go there. Like, you know, it's very cool. We see a sword girl that Zoro takes interest in, but we don't know why he's so interested yet. It might just be because he's like, oh, hey, a fellow swordsman,
Oh.
woman, swordswoman, whatever. But then, oh my God, we get to see like my two favorite boys in the world. On some island somewhere is what I think it said.
Yeah.
We see my favorite man, Mihawk, walking through some of these like final boss looking ass pirates. And he's just like, hey, this guy just kind of reminded me of stories you used to tell. Whatever. I'm not here to kill you guys. Just thought you might be interested. And so it's Captain Shanks. What is
Yay.
that? And like, man, I didn't think we'd see him again for a very long time,
No,
but here
man.
he is.
Shanks
No.
is important in the world. You're gonna see him from time to time.
Shanks has been like heavily foreshadowed.
Yeah, and it's just like it's
Yeah.
so cool because like I love Shanks' reaction to seeing Luffy's bounty. And it didn't surprise me at all. He's just like, "Oh hey, Luffy's finally out there, huh?" Like he's not surprised at all. He's proud. But he's not surprised, and it's just great.
And it's been like 8 years since he's seen Luffy, so it's like he, in the back of his mind, he's been waiting for that moment.
Oh yeah, like he's been waiting for it. He always knew it would be coming. He was just that confident in Luffy. And also we see Luffy's hometown right after that, and they're all happy that this notorious pirate came from their town because
Now,
one, because they love Luffy
as
and
I
they know.
recall, the mayor doesn't like it, right?
Yeah, the
Yeah.
mayor's like, oh, well, I
Yeah.
don't want our town to be known for this. But all these other people are like, well, you know,
Kind of cool.
he's more wanted than Arlong, but he's not Arlong. We know him. This is his dream. He's not a monster. And they're also like, oh, we're gonna be famous. So yeah,
Cool.
that's as far as I got.
All right. I very much look forward to you reading Rogue Town, Rogue Port, whatever.
I
Isn't it?
also
Ro
look forward to it.
it's, I think it's, I don't remember what they call it in the Viz version.
Some people know it as Luge Town too, because
Luke Town.
R's and
Yeah.
L's in Japan, in Japanese, you know how it goes. And yeah, I can't wait because you're getting to the start of One Piece.
No. All right.
right.
Oh God.
Okay.
Fucking bug landing on my face.
Oh geez, that's not good, because that bug needs to leave as we transition into the next topic.
No, he's gonna
Yeah.
want to hear it.
Okay, I'm sure he will. There's bugs involved in this game.
Hey.
So I finished Devil May Cry 5, and
That's
I
nice
also
shit.
finished Bayonetta 2,
Ooh.
in a relatively close span of time.
Yeah, Willer's finishing all his action games.
I've been on a big action game kick for months now,
Ooh.
ever since I was like, you know what? I'm going to play Devil May Cry 5. Let me get the collection and play 1 through 4, except 2. Because you're not supposed to play 2, so I didn't.
Yeah, when did Devil May Cry 5 come out?
Devil
How
May
recent
Cry
is that?
5 came out a cup like the March 5th or 15th, something like that.
Okay.
It came
2018
out
or 2019?
this year. It
Wait.
came out
Oh,
after
okay.
after Kingdom Hearts 3.
So, did we finally find out if the devil is going to cry or not?
Now, we've known Devils May Cry since Devil May Cry 1, so you can
Yes.
stop with your shitty jokes.
But so we know it's possible, but you know.
It's encouraged even.
Okay.
Wait, no, I'm still confused. Why do you skip two?
Two shit, and it's
Okay.
so bad that there's like a little video on Devil May Cry 5 where it's like, this is the story of Devil May Cry so far, and it goes into
Jesus.
the anime and the manga, but when you get to Devil May Cry 2, it's like, and then Devil May Cry 2 happened. Devil May Cry 3, a prequel. Like, it just skips directly from 2 to 3. It
Jeez.
is literally one line spare for 2.
I like that these long-running franchises like Devil May Cry and Kingdom Hearts kind of have recaps included now.
Yes, it is. Devil May Cry plot is actually people are pretty into it. Like, it there's a lot of good in there.
Yeah, that's the
I
thing is
feel
I'm excited to hear you talk about it because I actually know zero about Devil May Cry other than like what you've told me and video clips you've shown me.
I feel like the reason why a lot of these games like Kingdom Hearts and Devil May Cry like go into these hibernation stages is because I think they were made in a time where people just assumed that people wouldn't have loyalty to like gaming brands, if that makes sense.
Possibly. That
Because
actually, 2 has a different director than 1, and 3 and 4 and 5 have another director. So
right.
the guy in 2, like 2 has a really big development mess. So I think you might be onto something there.
Yeah, because I feel like there are a ton of games, like Kingdom Hearts is one for sure, where like they made one and two, and then they just started like making like smaller games, and then three comes out, and I think it's still the best-selling game in the UK. But yeah, anyways.
DMC3?
No. Kingdom Hearts
Oh,
3.
okay, yes. I got confused. All right. So before I talk about 5, if this is going to be my one chance on this podcast to talk about this genre, we're gonna dial it all the way back. We're gonna talk about DMC1,
Do he
DMC3,
go back?
4, Bayonetta 1, 2, and then finally Devil May Cry 5. And I took notes
All
to
right.
ease through this.
Doing it.
So, a little background on the Devil May Cry franchise. Devil May Cry 1. So, also, I played all of these in 2019, basically. I've never played them before. Got the collection. Played all the main ones. I didn't play the reboot. I was going to, but now I feel like there's no real point because 5 is just too good. Spoiler alert. But okay. Devil May Cry 1 was going to be Resident Evil 4.
Huh.
It was developed by Capcom around that time. It was planned to be that game. And the direction that game was going, from what I understand, was too action focused. So they retrofitted that into the Devil May Cry franchise.
It's too good. We have to make it its own franchise.
And then Devil May Cry, or then Resident Evil 4 came out, and it's considered by many to be the best game ever. So I'll get to playing that.
All right.
Especially after Resident Evil 2, which I will talk about next week, because holy shit, that is a good game. Okay. So, Devil May Cry 1, I've talked to you guys a little bit about it. In general, so with a name like Devil May Cry, you think the franchise would be like pretty edgy and like serious, but it's very goofy. It has serious plots, but Dante, the main character, and the combat system just are so clown shoes, goofy bullshit. Like, people describe Dante as woohoo pizza, yeah man.
Yeah,
Like,
it is like all over it's all over the place, isn't it?
yes, he is if Dante can be described as like a surfer slash skater cool, where the whole point of making him was they wanted to make a character who is cool, but not because he smokes, drinks, swears, or like does all these things that were traditionally cool in the early 2000s. They wanted to make a guy who is cool because he's stylish and is having fun.
God, what a wholesome boy.
And that is Dante. He is the most wholesome boy, but
Don't smoke, kids.
don't smoke. Except in Devil May Cry 5, where there's a character that smokes and
Oh,
everyone else
shit.
hates it. Like, and then
Smoke, bitch.
actually in Devil May Cry 5, like, there's a scene where she's smoking and she drives off, and then on the screen it says, "Please do not smoke," or like
Oh, my
there's
God.
like a PSA in the game. But
Oh, I
anyways,
love it.
so all these cool things I'm saying they're not really present in Devil May Cry 1 because Dante is kind of very serious in this game. The side characters aren't that interesting. It's an okay game. It's really dated. But it was definitely good for its time. But you know me,
You know me, dog.
I am not a nostalgic, like, good for its time kind of person. It's like,
They call him Willer the Nostalgia Critic.
no, the nostalgia hater. Because it's like, yeah, it was good for its time, but does it hold up today? Is it better than any of the games that followed it? No, it's not combat-wise. But it's actually still pretty fun. I went through it and I still had fun. One thing that I really hated about this game was the level design. So I said it was a Resident Evil game, and it shows where you'll get like this weird scepter or an artifact. You're in this island and in this big mansion in this game called Malay Island. And you'll get like these weird artifacts that you have to backtrack and put in doors to open more doors, and like there's weird platforming segments. It's fucking, I just want to fight shit, you know? And so the level of the design doesn't really help this game. Moving on to 3, as I said, we skipped 2. 3 is a great game. The combat is still interesting to this day. It introduces a style system for Dante that I'll get into later. It introduces a character called Virgil, which is Dante's brother, and his foil and his rival, and he's the antagonist of the game. And throughout the game, you're like, okay, we're building up to this fight between Dante and Virgil. Classic Capcom red versus blue, protagonist, antagonist, Mega Man, Proto Man, Ken, Ryu. You know how they do.
You know how we do.
Phoenix and Edgeworth, etc. And it's just it kept that annoying level design, but the actual layout of where you're in is more interesting, where you're in this big tower that's it's a tower that's coming up from hell and it's going up into the sky, and it's supposed to merge the demon world and the human world, and it's all part of Virgil's crazy plot, and in the middle there's some really good characters. This game's plot is actually, the more I think about it, the more I like it. It's got really strong themes about parenthood and maturing, and just great game. I can see why this is a lot of people's favorite. Then came 4. So 4 introduces a character called Nero. He plays different from Dante. He's got a simpler moveset, but there's still a lot of depth in the moveset. I sent y'all like a little preface, just explaining a little bit about the difference between the two.
Yeah, we got like the we got the comprehensive description, and man, not knowing anything about these games, reading that, I was like, holy shit, this is real.
Yeah, there's a lot going on with that. So if Dante is like surfer, skater, goofy, cool, like kind of like a goofy uncle trying to, who's not very self-aware of how lame he is, but that just makes him cooler. Nero's more like a punk. He's like a punk cool. And he's actually really enjoyable. He's really fun. The plot in this game is just okay, but the combat's fucking good. I was really surprised with the combat in this
Yeah,
one. I
because
really liked
that's
it.
like the main draw, right? Is
Yes.
the combat system.
The combat system in these games are great. That game, halfway through, you stop playing as Nero and you play the game as Dante. And Dante's moveset is great. He's got a bunch of weapons, he's got a bunch of styles. I will get more in depth with that concept later, but just bringing it up here. So playing him is like, you have, he's a Swiss Army knife of a character. Definitely set the bar for what would happen in 5. But when you play the campaign as Dante, you take Nero and you take him through this path and you get to the end point, and then you play as Dante and you go from that end point backwards to the beginning of the game. So you're playing all the same levels with just a few couple different twists, even more annoying
It's
gimmicks.
literally chain of memories. I'm just
I
fucking
mean, a little bit.
with
It's just chain of memories.
you. Chain of memories, there's no difference.
He's even fighting the same bosses, except he doesn't get to fight the one like amazing boss that Nero gets to fight. So it's like, ugh. So that game has structural problems, but combat-wise, it's great. It's got 3 extra playable characters because of the special edition DLC that came out. Really fun time. I didn't delve too into it with any of these games because in the end, they're not games that I wanted to play on hard mode or anything. where like I played my playthrough and I was good with them. I was like, if I'm gonna play one game to hard mode, it would probably be Devil May Cry 5. But besides that, I also around this time I picked up Bayonetta 1 and 2. So these games are in the same vein where they're the guy who made Devil May Cry 1 went on to make Bayonetta, as far as I understand. Please correct me if I'm wrong. So
I mean, it sounds accurate,
not you. I'm not
right?
talking to you.
To my almost zero knowledge.
Joe, you're probably flatlining right now. You can probably do that Google search for me while I
I'll
talk.
do it.
Thank you.
And man,
So
like think about the Bayonetta series is it's probably the most quickly I've seen like a video game series turn into an instant classic. Like when the first Bayonetta came out, like you'd imagine people had been fans for like over a decade.
I don't quite remember that. I remember that for two.
I just remember when it came out, people were like going nuts about it. People thought it was amazing.
Because Bayonetta 1 is a good fucking game, dude. So, with Bayonetta, compared to all the Devil May Cries I've talked about, I actually enjoy the combat in Bayonetta more. It's more dodge focused, and the way combat in Bayonetta works is she has a bunch of weapons. You can equip a weapon to her hands and a weapon to her feet. So, you can put like guns or shotguns or like grenade launchers on her feet, and you can put like a sword or a whip on her hand.
And she also has stando power.
Yes, she can use her hair to summon demons, which is part of her moveset. So a lot of the combat works with you can alternate between punch and kick, and depending on which weapons you equipped, your combo string will go differently. And the point is, you're trying to get to the end of the combo string to do a combo finisher with your stand, if that's how you want to understand it. Huh. So I think it's a really cool system. It's she's got an insanely huge moveset because of it, but it's not necessarily as diverse function-wise as the kind of stuff you were seeing in Devil May Cry 3 and 4, where your moveset isn't as big as Bayonetta's, but each move has a function. Like Nero has a move called Shuffle, which is back to forward and then you press attack, where he will do a back step and do like a golf swing, I guess is the best way to explain it. And that move has invincibility frames in the start. Or Dante has a move called Stinger, which Bayonetta also has, but it's like a gap closer, and he can teleport to people, and everything has its own function. Bayonetta just has a bigger move set, which is pretty fun and flashy, but that is a difference between the two games. Overall, I like Bayonetta more as a character, but I like the plot of Devil May Cry better. So that's one thing. And to compare one to two, I played two really recently. I really like one. People say that one's combat is better because it's a little stricter with the combo system. It's not as dodge heavy. Instead, it has this. It focuses more on this system called dodge offset, where if you do punch, and then you hold punch and dodge, you will be in that same combo when you come out of the dodge. So you can do
Kind
punch,
of
kick with a dodge in the middle.
input buffering or something.
Something like that. And the
Not exactly,
way I didn't really get it at first, but then I realized Bayonetta's moves, if you punch and you hold the punch button, and say you have these claw weapons that explode in flame, like that's their gimmick, right? If you hold that button, she will start doing the flame explosion. Or if you have guns equipped to her feet, equipped to her
exactly.
equapped, equipped to her feet, and you hold the kick button, she'll start shooting the guns and be stuck in pose until you click kick again, and then she'll do the second kick of the combo, right? That's there, so you can kind of delay your combo, and you can hold the button and have an attack coming out and wait for an enemy to attack you while the button is held, so you can easily dodge offset your combos doing that. I don't know if that makes sense explaining it, but it's a really smart system.
I was kind of able to follow, though. Of course, I feel like anyone would have to, play it to get the full understanding.
I'll bring it over sometime and I'll show you. But the thing with Bayonetta 1 is the enemies are kind of harder to read. And this is a problem I had with the Devil May Cry series as well. And it's hard to tell what enemies are doing sometimes because of the colors and just the way that their animations go. And it's a bit frustrating. You get used to it, but it's not as immediately clear as some other games. But overall, I think I like Bayo 2 better. It's got way cooler cutscenes. It's flashier. It's a little bit. It's a the skill ceiling, I guess, or the skill floor, I would say, is a bit lower than it was in Bayonetta 1, where it's easier for you to get into. But it's the one that made Bayonetta click with me. The one thing I will give Bayonetta 1 over 2 is the bosses in 1 are better for the most part. While 2 has better level design, where it's more fight, 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 do a little mini game, fight, fight, fight. One thing I dislike about both the Bayonettas is how the ranking system works, where you have a bunch of battles that you can go through, but a lot of them are secret battles. So if you don't get it at the end of your mission, your ranking goes down. You can get like bronze, silver, gold, platinum, and pure platinum each battle.
So you kind of
And
have to like go back through the level again and
yes, exactly, which is especially bad in Bayonetta 1, where it's a real big hassle to sometimes you have to backtrack to the beginning of the level after like the seventh battle to get the eighth battle, or else you missed it. And if you missed it, your ranking at the end of the end of the whole chapter will be negatively affected.
you kind of have to play the game like 1.5 times if you don't get it all on the first go.
Oh, dude, I get to the point where I play with a guide. I play two with like a okay, I want to play every single battle. So I'm gonna double check this to make sure I go back, and this is kind of how I went. All right, with all of that out of the way, I had to get that out of the way because Devil May Cry is the evolution of this genre. It is the stopping point of the genre.
Yeah, this is like what we've been building up to. This is like what their game design philosophy has culminated in.
And to talk about five, it's just pure insanity. It looks so fucking good. It has three different playable characters, and they're all super unique from each other. So you got, I'll go over each one a little bit just quickly to get an idea of how they play differently. So Nero, like I said, he's got a simpler move set, but what he does have is he has moves that can bring enemies closer to you. I'm gonna get into some mechanic spoilers here also if you haven't played Devil May Cry 5. I can say it to these guys because they have no investment, even though I would like for them to play. If it's anyone else, like they should probably tap out if they don't want certain spoilers.
Tap
But
out. I feel like, never mind. You can go ahead.
no, Joe, please. I want to
I
hear your beautiful voice.
feel like the Devil May Cry and Bayonetta series aren't the series that you really tie a strong story to.
No, but mechanic spoilers though are big deals in this
Yeah,
game.
because it's like whenever you see like a new weapon for the first time, you're like, oh my God, this is so cool. They might not want to be spoiled on that.
Yeah, and there's stuff over that. So with Nero, if you press your there's a button that revs your sword and it gives you meter, which lets you do stronger moves basically. If you press the button right as you hit an attack or after you finish an attack, you get one bar. If you do a frame perfect, you get all three. So as you're swinging your sword, you're revving your sword at the same time and you're trying to time it. Meanwhile, you're doing all the inputs for your moves. And this is the spoiler. He has a thing called Buster, which is like a stand arm, which will let you do a grab on an enemy that's stunned. And most small enemies can just get Bustered, and he does cool wrestling moves. And you can mix that into your combos. He's got an arm system where each arm does a different thing. Like I said, he can ride one of his arms like a rocket. One of his arms is Mega Man's Buster, since it's both Capcom. He even jumps like Mega Man. They each get a super that they can use, which breaks the arms, which then cycles into your other arms. So you get like a giant beam, or you get to stop time, like Zawarldo, stuff like that. So just immediately, he's got a lot of going on. It's just he has one weapon and a really strong gun, and then all these extra things for you to spice up your combos. Because
Spicy.
at the end of the day, this whole genre is built on you doing cool combos, and you actually get ranked for how intricate and how non how much you mix up your combos basically and how little you get hit and stuff like that. You have a character called V, who's the new character, and like I said, basically one button controls a panther, the other button controls a bird, and you use those to attack, and he's controlling them, so you're trying to move him out of harm while you control the two animals, and it just works really well. He's got the smallest moveset of the bunch, but it's a really fun one to play, and he's probably the easiest to play just because once you get used to it, you can do so much crazy shit with him. And the way it works is you can knock enemies down at 0 HP, but then you have to kill them yourself with your cane. So one way he can do this is he can teleport to people and stab them with this cane, or he can do like a summon a bunch of like canes that rain down on enemies for like some of his meter. So he has a devil trigger, which is like once you have enough meter, you can activate this mode. Dante and spoiler Nero also have them, but for his is he summons like a giant golem that attacks by itself. Or you can ride it to control it, but I don't like riding it because it just moves so damn slow. And while that's happening, that golem is creating hell, which lets you do some of Nero's or some of V's other things, such as you can read a book. And
Right.
reading a book, he reads out poetry from William Blake, I believe.
Holy crap.
And he so his whole theme, if Dante is Woohoo Pizza Man. And Nero
Pizza.
is punk boy. He's emo goth boy reading poetry. But everyone loves him because he's just such a good character, and he's so corny that it just works. And he's reading poetry, and it's building your meter back up. Or you can taunt with him, and he has the best taunts where he will just conduct an orchestra or play a violin with his cane, and it actually changes the music to classical music. An interesting thing with him is that he moves real slow. So to dodge, he uses either his panther or his bird. He grabs onto the bird, or he rides the panther like a surf wave, because it moves like a shadow. So because of that, if you're dodging, you're taking your animal out of the battle, so they're not attacking anymore. So if you want to get a good mix between dodging and attacking, you have to be really conscious of that. And that's V. And then you got Dante. So Dante, like I said, he has the biggest, most complex move set of any character
In
in any
anything.
game, in anything. It's crazy.
I was thinking, like, you sent us like this paragraph listing out all of his different like weapons and attacks and stuff he can do. And when I got to the end, I was like, wait, that's one character?
Right, and I didn't even get to all of his shit. So he's got four styles, four weapons, and four guns. With the styles, he's had them since Devil May Cry 3. In 4, he can switch them freely. And now he can even switch them like mid combo without a problem. Trickster gives him like a dash that's fully invincible, gives him an air dash, and most importantly, it gives him a teleport. If you press forward and the style button while you're locked onto someone, you'll teleport right in front of them, which melds really well into his combos because unlike Nero, he can't bring people to him. So what you do is you knock people away and you teleport to them and you keep the combo going. That's one style, that's Trickster. You have Swordsmaster, which with the style button, now all of your weapons have different moves. So I'll talk about some of them later. He has Gunslinger, which gives his gun different moves. And then he's got Royal Guard, which lets you block with the style button. And if you time a block perfectly, you get a ton of Devil Trigger meter, you get a ton of style. And it doesn't cost any Devil Trigger meter, but if you hold the block, it starts slowly draining it. So it's like really perfectly balanced that way. It's
This
easier
whole
to
thing should be.
use. It used to like I used to hate this style, but now that you can just hold it and like you just have to manage your resources, I actually learned how to use it. That was a really good choice on their part.
Devil May Cry is a resource management game. Hear
It
that, Joe?
really is, Joe. Especially when I talk about his devil trigger. But okay, with weapons, he's got his sword. He's actually got three different swords in this game, but in the end you're gonna be using one of them, which gives him like little summon blades as well as you're fighting. Really standard moveset. It's always good. Then you get the weird shit. So you got a fist and kick combo called Balrog, which if you switch it into it's two weapons in one. If you switch it into fist mode and you land 10 hits, it heats up and your moves start doing more damage. It punches really fast. You can hold triangle and he starts bobbing and weaving. Which, if you dodge moves while you're doing the bob and weave, because you can go side to side, the game slows down and you feel like a cool boxer. It's maximum style.
And like this is another thing when I was reading the stuff you sent me, where I was like, even like the base amount of weapons, I'm like, this is already like, holy shit, there's this many weapons. But then you get into it, and each weapon has like multiple different weapons within it or play styles, and you're like, holy shit.
Exactly. So I was talking about Swordmaster, right? That gives each weapon and you like more attacks as well. So now with the fist portion, you can do like a hurricane punch, you can do giant shoryukens. With the kick form, you can do like capoeira. moves, and you can heat it up by holding triangle, and he does like a quick little dance, and you're doing strong kicks with that while you're doing quick blows with the punches, and you just get like a little flash kick like Guile does with the Swordmaster, stuff like that. Next up, you unlock motorcycle nunchucks, I think is the best way to say it. He gets two motorcycle wheels for each hand, and as you're swinging them, if you don't press the button and you let the wheel spin on the enemy, you get extra damage. So you're supposed to time your combo to where you're letting the wheel spin. They're really slow, but they're really strong. You get armor while you're doing it. In Swordmaster, though, you combine both of the wheels and you just make it into a motorcycle, and you're just fighting with a goddamn motorcycle. And you're swinging it around, and you're doing the same mechanic where you let the wheel spin on your enemy, etc., etc. You're doing wheelies that launch enemies into air combos. It's really fun. And that's like, as cool as that is, that's probably my least favorite weapon, and it's still like the coolest shit. And then you get my baby,
A
called
babe.
King Cerberus, which is a three triple nunchuck that is ice formed,
Hold
and
on,
you
you gotta
can.
say that sentence again. Three triple nunchuck that's ice formed. Like,
You
just
get.
like hearing that, hearing those words together in that order, how could you not be like, I gotta see this? Like,
It's to be fair, I lied. It is one nunchuck that is, God, it is a set of nunchucks that have three little chucks. You know, whatever. You
I know
it's
what
a
you're saying.
big nunchuck. It has ice element. You can make crystals. You can make like a little snowstorm. That's all with a triangle button. If you hold that button, you can change it into an electric three-section staff that lets you shoot like sparks, and it lets you extend it a big distance and like a thrust. And then in Swordmaster, your style button becomes a flaming pole. So this is three weapons in one now, where you have cool pole moves, where you get to like pole vault at the enemy and you get to swing at them. And if you hold that button, you also get electric moves with that button as well. So you just, there's just so much. And those are his weapons. Then for guns, he has pistols, and each pistol, it's called Ebony and Ivory, and Ivory shoots fast while Ebony shoots slow but staggers enemies. And Gunslinger, you can shoot him in the air and do like jumps and shit. He gets a shotgun that lets you do what's called Gun Stinger, which is he dashes forward and then he blasts you with the gun up close. That's how you get distance in Gunslinger mode. It lets you do like rolls and shoot and shit. It lets you flip around your shotgun like a nunchuck, and then just shoot all around you. It just looks really cool. You get two, you get not one, but two fucking rocket launchers, which just shoot rockets. They shoot a bunch of them, and if you hold them, they shoot a laser. And in Gunslinger mode, they shoot like a giant laser that you get to control by combining both of the rocket launchers on top of each other. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, like it's crazy because like you look at the aesthetic of the game and you get this like kind of like really intense, maybe serious vibe, but the actual like stuff you're doing and just the concept of some of these weapons is so just like ridiculous. It's
That
hilarious.
should really give you the tone where it's like, oh, it's in a serious setting, kind of, but
But
like,
they just
look
love
at
going
this
over the
goofy
top.
shit. And then your final weapon, your final gun, is a hat. And you
Okay.
put this hat on, and in the game, you have a currency called Red Orbs. And this is your currency for the game. You have to spend it to get new skills and to buy items and stuff. Now, your hat gets a scarf that's as long proportionally to how many red orbs you have. And what you do with this hat is you get to, when you have it, if you press the gun button, you shoot out all your orbs. And the longer you hold it, the more orbs you lose, but the more damage you do. You can throw your hat like Cappy, and you put the hat on a person, and it can be put on any enemy, including the most serious of bosses. And now if you hit that enemy, you get more red orbs out of them. So suddenly, this weapon where you're using red orbs also gives you more red orbs. So it's a good way to farm, and it's high risk, high reward. Because if they hit you while they have the hat, you lose the orbs. It's just really fun. It has different. It can shoot down red orb meteors. It can summon like a stand that's wearing the hat. It's like a little ghost that shoots like a turret. And that's all for the Dante part. I say that's all, but like I went way too long. But there's so much to him.
I'll say there's a lot to talk about.
It's really, if I'm going to do this justice, I feel like Devil May Cry fans would be very angry if I didn't acknowledge how cool all this shit is. And you mix them all together, like you get your trickster to teleport. Gunslinger's my favorite, even if it's hard to use. Swordmaster gives you a bunch of cool attacks, etc. You got all that. You got a game with a good plot that's full of fan service for the series. You got really good enemies. I complained about the enemies being hard to read, but these are pretty good. They have a lot of depth to them. The one flaw of the game is the environment's kind of boring. It's pretty samey a lot of the time, but it looks very pretty. Difficulty modes are good. This is the one where I've actually I'm still playing it. I was playing it before the podcast started, where I'm actually playing the difficulty modes. I beat hard mode. I'm currently in a mode called Dante Must Die, where enemies have 800% their normal attack and health. That mode kind of fucking sucks.
Oh.
You don't want enemies to be damage sponges. Like it, I'm still having fun, but I want to unlock the difficulty after that, where enemies have normal health, but they kill you in like 3 hits. I feel like that's more my style.
Yeah, that's probably the kind of thing I'd go for also.
So
Yeah.
when I said, but even the standard hard mode is like perfectly balanced. They do something cool in the hard modes of these games, where they vary up what kind of enemy spawn in certain places. So, oh shit, first mission, you're fighting one of the really hard enemies, and like they completely remix every battle. But also, especially bosses, they get brand new moves. And I really like that. The final boss of this game might be the best boss of all time, at least in an action game for sure. I'd probably put Mother 3's final bosses above it from like an emotional level, but like this
I mean,
is
it's fucking Mother
you
3.
know, we'll talk about it one day.
Oh, I know. Oh, I know.
But right below that is this final boss of this game is fucking nuts.
Wow.
Yeah, it's that when I said that this game made it into my top 10, like Bayonetta might be top 10, top 20, I'd have to reconsider it. Devil May Cry 5 is definitely top 10 for me.
Like, people don't realize that Willer saying a boss is like the next step behind Mother 3's final boss is like the highest praise something is going to
That
get.
means I just put him over Xemnas, that and
Yeah.
Xehanort. That's how good this boss is. Which, okay. I said all of this to praise this game because I really needed to. I really want y'all to know that I'm not just talking about a cool game. I'm talking about something monumental here, where it breaks into my top three, and
Jeez.
it's that important because the combat system is so good
Is a coveted position.
that it rivals my favorite combat system of all time, which is Kingdom Hearts 2. And
So,
this is where I'm gonna lose every. So no matter if you came here for Bayonetta talk, no matter if you came here for Devil May Cry talk, this is where I'm gonna lose everyone. But
everyone's like, "Oh, you like Kingdom Hearts 2?
let me.
Recoded was way better."
Okay, that's not. No one's gonna fucking say that.
No one's
But
gonna say
let me just
that.
defend my position here. I knew it would come down to this, but Kingdom Hearts 2, level 1 specifically. And to a lesser degree, Kingdom Hearts 3 Critical Mode also should be in these talks because it's a really good difficulty. It's probably below both Bayonetta 2 and Devil May Cry 5 easily, but you know,
You
it's worth
seem really
mentioning.
satisfied with the critical mode for Kingdom
Oh,
Hearts 3.
it's freaking great. You die so quick. It's perfect.
So good.
And unlike that game's level 1, you still do damage. So, level 1 Kingdom Hearts 2 is so perfectly balanced, where you always do great damage even though you're level 1. There's no grinding because you can't level up. So it isn't character action game because you can't just it's more of a character action game than Devil May Cry 5 because in Devil May Cry 5, you have an item called gold orbs which you can just use after you die, which instantly revives you in the middle of a fight, and it's your choice not to use it, but it is totally there for you to cheese. Which you know is good because people can struggle with these games. But
Yeah, some
like
people.
I used it. Like I had a boss at like 1%, and I was like, you know what? It reduces your rank to where you're not gonna get an S rank, but like I'll come back to that boss later. I just wanted to get on to the next mission. So I did use it. So it's good that it's there. Kingdom Hearts level 1, you're going to learn these fucking bosses because they're going to kill you in 1 to 2 hits.
See,
And
this is how we get the listeners. We tell them it's a Devil May Cry talk, but it
I
was
tricked
actually.
them, Bradley. I did it. I got him 30 minutes in. It's so the thing is why this rivals that game. Kingdom Hearts 2 for me is a low complexity as far as your input, but it's high complexity in your decision making. I would say Devil May Cry 5 is kind of the opposite, where your inputs, you're like, I'm doing crazy shit with my fingers that you don't understand. I'm switching styles and weapons and revving Nero's sword and controlling a cat and a bird. Okay, there's a lot going on. But a lot of the times, your dodge options in Devil May Cry is you roll or you jump, because jump has iframes. So because of that, a lot of the time my decision making is read an enemy attack, get my hits in, jump away, shoot my gun, because I'm always charging my gun, and then I can kind of try to come in at a different angle and try to get some cool combos in there. So there's still decisions to be made, but the decisions I have to make when I play Kingdom Hearts 2 Level 1 are just crazy. Like, the way that game works is I have to manage my MP, I have to manage my combo because the revenge value system is so perfect. This isn't my official Kingdom Hearts 2 talk. I'll have to do it later, but you guys
Yeah,
know what I'm talking
what we're
about.
trying to say is Devil May Cry is almost Kingdom Hearts 2 out of 5. So.
Yes, it's. It might be better. It might be the thing Kingdom Hearts 2 has over it is definitely the enemies. Like, as like they might not look cool to a lot of people, but I think they're really well designed enemies. The way you stagger enemies in Kingdom Hearts 2 is like you're attacking them, they're getting staggered. They're not gonna teleport mid combo out of it unless you push your combo too far, which some enemies in Devil May Cry, they will teleport out of your combo so fast that you have to know exactly how to get them in the combo. It's a little bit frustrating, and you there are ways around it, but like it's just a lot more flexible in two. And because you can't dodge out of your combos like you can say in three, in Kingdom Hearts 3, you have to know that you're doing your combo at the right time, that you're not pushing it too far. And as a result, bosses in those games are just universally, and there's not a single bad boss in Devil May Cry 5, which is the miracle, because in other Devil May Cry games it was like there's two good bosses in the whole game. Well, in this one there's no bad bosses, they're all great. But they don't quite match up to Kingdom Hearts 2 bosses for me. So, final verdict. This is a 5 out of 5 game. It's in my top 10 games. So is Kingdom Hearts 2. Bayonetta 2, very good as well.
Devil May Cry 5 featuring Dante from the Devil May Cry series.
Thank you all for putting up with my grossly overtimed, almost double. Actually, double the allotted time, but I had to do it. Otherwise, it
Yeah,
wouldn't
I
be
had to
worth
do it.
it. All
Hi,
right. So
everybody.
next up we have Total War, yes,
Total
Total War
War.
Three Kingdoms, Joe's big so I just
Oh.
got to nut everywhere, and now Joe gets to nut everywhere
Yeah.
because
Joe's
we're
been waiting for this for a very long time.
Yes,
This
he
is like the
has.
most hype I've seen him for something in a really long time.
So let me I'll explain, I'll get into that. And I need to start off with basically just a quick background. I've always really just enjoyed like board games and overarching like kind of strategy games. Like Risk is like, your baby's first grand campaign, take over the world strategy game. There's things that build onto it. And so really the pinnacle for the series, or mainstream of the series, that everyone kind of relates to is Civilization, where you have your own civ and then you build cities and then you make some armies and you send them off to go conquer places, and then you also have like trading and diplomacy that you have to do and so on and so forth. And that's like the main focus of the game. Total War is so unique in that it's basically two games in one game. It's so strange.
How so?
Essentially, because so you have like this grand campaign, like board game kind of setting where it's like, here's your capital, here's a bunch of other cities, your goal is just to take over all the other cities. It eliminates any kind of choice of like settlements and stuff of like where to settle, but essentially you deal with historical settings of like, here's this state, this city, this city, this faction, this country, so on and so forth. So you still have to balance like, oh, I have to build an army, and then I have to manage trade agreements, and then I have to declare war on people, or I can try to vassalize people, or I had to do this whole diplomatic and balancing the happiness of my people and then the happiness of a whole like just a kind of like a management simulation for your country almost. But then what usually happens in these other 4X games these grand like campaign kind of games is when you get to combat, everything is simulated. You're like, oh man, your army's attacking. You did 5 damage. In Total War, when two armies meet, you have the option to play out the full battle with that army that's in the stack.
Yeah, I want to stress to people who might not even be into like strategy type stuff or this type of game, like go fucking look at some gameplay of this. Like it's not like this other stuff where you send a group of people and you just can kind of forget about them, whatever they're there. Like each you like you can zoom in like and see each individual guy doing his fighting, like they're all their own people, and it is so fucking cool.
Yeah, and that's been like that was kind of like the big staple for the game for a very, very long time. That was the biggest draw, was actually the massive battles and like having each like little man on the field like actually matter, and you have to move him in conjunction. And so Total War really, and so really that campaign aspect of it was always a like a sidecar to these battles. Like they were always just kind of like reasons to have these battles. And so whenever you played Total War games, you're like, I really like the battles and stuff and whatever. The campaign match really lacking. It's really not that interesting and fun. It's not, it's fun, but it's really kind of not that many dimensions. And then Three Kingdoms comes along and just flips the whole table, and it's like we're redoing this whole system that we have in place for the campaign. So they did comp that was the biggest complaint for a long time for longtime Total War fans, was that they never fleshed out their diplomatic and grand strategy part of the game. They stuck to like fine-tuning their battles and making the battles fun and unique, or just kind of being historically faithful. But like when you got to the campaign setting, there was so little you could actually do, and you just kind of had to accept that. So Three Kingdoms took their system for that and reinvented it, totally overhauled, and the amount of option you have now exceeds what Civ gives you in terms of like agreements and diplomatic ploys and
Jesus.
espionage. Yeah, it's crazy. So to back it up, Three Kingdoms is set in the Three Kingdoms period of China. This is like just like right before. The essential plot is that a warlord named Dong Zhuo captures the young emperor and holds the entire country hostage, basically. When that happens, a group of warlords like team up and try to take over, like kick Dong Zhuo out, but he escapes and takes Child Emperor with him. They have this huge argument, and then they're like, fine, you know what? I'm gonna take China for myself. So now you have like 11 warlords just scattered throughout the entire realm, ready to just take over China for their own sake. So what ends up happening is you have to do all these diplomatic exchanges with these different warlords, and you have to conquer land and territory, and try to reclaim the mandate of heaven, which is the idea that, God sent you from high above and made you like the rightful ruler of the kingdom. So in history, there's a whole bunch of like political intrigue that happens during this time. Like it's insane. Like there's tons of backstabbing, political marriages, heirs, death threats, usurpers, just all these like basically Game of Thrones style stuff. But it culminates into, which is three kingdoms forming inside of China. And I think the game does a really good job of getting to that point. And it's a really fun kind of like, all right, we're in the end game now. Let's get started. And that's something that Total War has always lacked, is a narrative, like something narrative to drive you and like really kind of like guide you along this path. Because a lot of times you're just kind of thrown into a set time period and not given really any context of like what the hell is happening. You're just like, all right, you're in charge of Rome. There's some dudes, just kind of make the biggest country you can, and you'll be fine. You'll be okay. And so that was the first kind of big improvement that I saw from this game when I was like really like looking into it. It's like, oh man, there's like an actual kind of story that you're following. You're not really stuck in like some sort of like weird period where there's just a lot of fighting. There was an actual, well, number one, book written about this period, but there was actual like plot point and beats that happened throughout this entire process that could have been literally anybody that was involved in this scenario.
Hey Joe, I got a tangential question. Why do you call it 4X games?
That stands for exploration, exploitation, extermination, and another X. I can't
Ooh,
remember.
learning the terminology
Extreme.
here.
Not extreme.
But I got you. I got you.
College X Games.
They're essentially like you have, let's see. It means explore, expand, exploit, exterminate. So yeah, you're basically. That's just the core concept, is that you figure out where things are, you expand to that, you try to take as much of the resources you can, and then if anything gets in your way, you kill them.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Moving on.
So that was one thing I really, really appreciate about this game, is you have this narrative of what's happening, and that really was shown kind of at first in Warhammer, the Total War Warhammer, where they're like, it's like you need to basically amass an army big enough to the point where you can fight off chaos, which is essentially this apocalyptic army that comes and just starts destroying everything in its path.
Like supernatural army?
That's its whole, yes, for to
Okay.
make things simple, yes, it's essentially like armies from demon gods that they're just like, yeah, go kill everything, and they go off and
Oh.
it's the best way to describe it is like you basically have to get enough land and get enough armies to fight off the White Walkers from Game of Thrones.
Right. And then you gotta do it good, though.
Yeah, you gotta do it good. That's Warhammer. So in Three Kingdoms, what ends up happening is that once someone, it may not be you, someone gets enough territory, the Emperor of China like abdicates his throne, which means there's no emperor in China. So the three strongest factions of the game announce themselves as emperor. So the end game of the game is then you have to take down the two other false emperors and claim yourself as the true emperor of China, which is what happens in history for the Three
So
Kingdoms.
to run that back, like the two other enemy emperors can change depending.
Yes.
Cool.
So like so in history, the three emperors that end up declaring themselves are Cao Cao, Liu Bei, and Sun Jian's son, Sun She.
Oof.
They declare themselves emperors, and so now and then for like the next like 100 year, not 100, but like 50 or 60 years, there were three like big empires in China that were basically always at a cold war, constant war at each other because they wanted to be the one true emperor of China. So when you get to this period, you then have to claim basically most of the territory on the map and take their two seats from their throne and force them to abdicate from being emperor of China. It's a long, long, long process. But the big thing is this is like the first kind of open campaign game where it's like from Total War that's like, here's your goal. And here's where you know you're reaching the end of the game. Go do it. That isn't just like capture all this land, have about this much money in your bank account by the end of the game, and then we'll call it good. Like there's a very solid, like, here is what you're trying to accomplish, which is dope. I really appreciate that because I do not like games that are just like I don't have a solid reason for you to play or an end goal to obtain. Like it just blows my mind. But so that's kind of the overarching plot of the game. So the digging deep, the big thing about this game that I really appreciate, that I really, really like, and it was something that blew my mind, is the system that they call Guanxi, which is the idea of brotherhood and relationships. So in past Total War games, if you wanted an army, you would have to recruit, you would just be like, build me an army. And then they would just like, all right, pick a random dude from here. You know, this guy gets like plus 10 attack. This guy gets, you know, some public order bonuses. And this guy, you know, you get some extra money. And you pick your dude. And then you just like fill up his army with some other dudes and you go off and run. In this game, you have to pick and choose your generals very, you have to pick them very carefully because number one, each general is its own class. meaning that certain generals will be really good at taking archers, but be really bad with like their cavalry or their linemen or their like basic foot soldiers, so they don't have access to those more advanced foot soldiers. So for that army to have those more advanced foot soldiers, you gotta take another general in that army that will have those soldiers with him. And when you recruit soldiers into each of these generals' retinues, those soldiers and those units will stay with that general for life. Like you can replace them, but essentially, like where it doesn't matter where they go, those units are with those generals like forever. Like those are the same men and the same dudes that have been fighting with them the entire time, essentially, which is really cool. But then as well, your generals have their own different traits, and if you put a general with another general and they don't like each other, it can cause infighting and cause like a general to just revolt and leave that army or leave your entire faction and go join your enemy faction and fight you instead. And so you have to be like, all right, this general doesn't like this guy, so I gotta just feed him gold or titles just so he can stay happy, because I really need these infantrymen because they're really good. On the flip side, you can have dudes that are like oath sworn to themselves. So you have they when they're on the battlefield, they'll just fight even harder when they're with this other person that they love, lifelong brother, and they're great. And it's just such a cool dynamic because those carry over to across the whole game. And if one character leaves your faction, that they don't just like get deleted from the game. They go into like the character pool, and another faction on the map can recruit that character.
Ooh.
And now, like your former like top general could be instead the top general of your enemy because you just decided not to promote him for.
That seems kind of fun, not gonna lie.
Yeah, so you create these really like dynamic stories, and if you have like two generals are like oath sworn and like best buds, and one of them dies, that general remembers which general's army killed that man. But then
Oh.
he gets a rivalry, like a rivalry bonus, like a bonus to him whenever he faces him on the battlefield because he's like, I want to kill him. But that sucks when it's your faction leader that dies and your heir takes over, because then you have like almost a permanent buff to that faction because he's like, that country or that faction killed my dad, so I'm not gonna let that faction live ever, which means you're basically at war with him for the rest of your life.
Unless you get rid of that commander.
Well, essentially, yeah. So another thing about Total War is you start off with like your leader. So like I started with Cao Cao as my commander. He gets married and then he has kids, and so you had to declare who's your heir. And when you have an heir, and when Cao Cao dies, that heir takes over. And he like maintains any kind of memories or like relationships that he personally carried over. So if
Is
Cao Cao and whenever another faction, like their two leaders got really along with each other, and Cao Cao dies, he might not get along with Cao Cao's son, meaning that you'll take a penalty hit to your politics because they're like,
Jesus.
I don't like you. Your dad was kind of cool, but you're a bit of a shit, and you're just like.
Is that marriage thing scripted for Cao Cao, or is that something everyone goes through, or?
No, like you have to base like Cao Cao starts off with a wife, but like you could start with Liu Bei, who doesn't have a wife, and you have to go and find a wife out there, like just be like, marry me, marry me, marry me, and you need to get married or else you won't have like a lineage of people to give to pass this faction down to, and if you don't have someone to pass it down to, it could potentially start a civil war within your own generals who each think they should be in charge of that faction.
Jesus.
Yeah. So you have to be like, okay, I'd like to have a wife, please. I'd like to have a son because, I need to pass this down and make sure all the things go to shit. And so with the exception of a few factions that don't follow that system and are just a point like the strongest guy that you have. But that's never been the thing in Total War. You just kind of had a general, and he was just like, he like, good, you have a kid, you don't have to worry about, infighting, which was a random chance. But since like your characters, when you like send them away, they don't leave, they just go into a character pool, it makes them so much more permanent, and each of your things, everything that you do with them, so much more meaningful. And just like, oh God, I can't just like, you have to try to please everyone, but also be like, well, this guy's leaving. He's gonna be fucking pissed at me. I hope he doesn't come and try to kill me later.
I'm guessing this isn't a game you'd recommend to like a newbie to the genre, 'cause like from everything you say, if I was to get into one of these 4X strategy games, this seems like a really cool one, but it seems like it'd be really hard.
But that's the thing, though, is like they've done a really good job of the big thing for me for 4X strategy games that's really difficult and hard to wrap around with is the numbers. Like, you just like Paradox Games, I think, is the furthest up that there is in terms of just like all the possibilities and simulations to it. But and it's so many numbers going at the same time that it makes your head want to spin. Total War really doesn't have that many things you need to juggle, and even if there are numbers, they're like, all right, listen, hey, here's a bar to give you a basic idea of like how good this is, or here is a a happy face or sad face. You can get an idea of like how much this person likes or dislikes you, and you can break it down from there. They make a they
So
have
there's good UI to help you
this UI is the best
inform.
I've seen in a Total War game. It's so good. And they have a function now where you can hit F1 and it just like it covers everything in like these white boxes, and you can hover over it and it breaks down like, this is what this does, this is what this does, here's everything for this, and you can right click those boxes
Oh,
and
perfect.
it brings you to a tutorial video on YouTube that it breaks it down even more. So you're just like, ah, oh, okay, I see what you mean. And the thing is, like, you don't have to sit through a lengthy tutorial to do that. It's just like you hit it, it's like, I don't know what this means. Oh, okay. Like, I was doing that myself. Like, this is one of those game, like a game that just like it really overhauled the way like Total War worked. And it was such a refreshing thing. And like, I was behind the difficulty curve for a while, and I had to restart a campaign like 3 times to like get my footing. It's like, all right, I have an idea of what I need to do now. And like, even now, like, I'll go on this guy will post like this huge like breakdown. I'm just like, oh, I've missed so much, and now I just want to restart everything because I can do it so much better.
How long is that campaign?
Oh God. So I'm on like my first like actual one going. I'm at 53 hours.
Jesus Christ. Okay, never mind, man.
No, it's
that's such a commitment.
these are games that are like you're meant to sit down and just play for a long, long
So
time.
this explains a lot where like I know people like you and some of our other coworkers in the past and other friends that like their life is playing 1,000 hours of these games, and I think I'm starting to see why.
Yeah. And the thing is like, I've only touched on like one system that's in the game. Like, the whole spy system got revamped too, where you could essentially like send the spy to another faction and then coerce that faction to adopt you into their family tree, which will allow you to become the heir of that faction, that spy to become the heir of the faction, assassinate the actual faction leader, and then just basically hand over all their land to you.
That does seem cool, though.
Yeah.
I wish it didn't.
And the thing is, like, I honestly don't think the 4X strategy part of that is the most difficult part to get your head wrapped around, because it's slow, it's turn-based, so you have all the time in the world to think about what you're doing. It's the real-time strategy battles that happen, and they're super cool, and they but you really need, if you haven't played an RTS before, it's pretty difficult to do a Total War battle because it's so different from any other RTSs, because you have to because most RTSs focus on how fast can I kill this unit, whereas Total War is like how fast can I get this unit to run, and you have to do that by either like using flaming arrows or positioning units in a certain way that causes that makes a certain that makes a unit that you're trying to make run think it's being overwhelmed and run away. And there's just so many different things going on. Also, they introduced a new system for this game being called Romance Mode that makes your generals like a one unit, like hero unit that can go out and just duel other generals, and they'll have like their own showdown in the middle of the field where everyone else just scoots along the side and they do these crazy battle animations, like taking the guy's spear, throwing at him, and the guy catches it and then he throws it back, and then they
Yo,
yeah.
I like
It's
that.
great. But yeah, I think this game is like the best Total War game in a long, probably like they've made. The biggest downside is I think the battles are just they're not as entertaining as Warhammer battles. But I say that, but I don't think there's a way you can make a historical game battles much more entertaining compared to a game that literally has dinosaurs and dragons fighting each other.
Seems like a different genre almost at
I
that
will
point.
say, like you're not gonna get like the wild you might not get the same wild scenarios that Warhammer has, but like God, it's like with Three Kingdoms, it's almost mesmerizing to watch all those little guys down there fighting each other,
Yeah.
because God, it's just so intricate.
And what's sad though, Bradley, is that when you get to a point where you're playing doing everything above, you don't get the time to like zoom in and just watch things
Man, because the
because
scale of the battle is just getting insane.
yeah, and you're just like I it's like and especially when you're on your ropes, because there are times where like I'm gonna lose this battle unless I micromanage the hell out of these horses, and it's the only way I win, because the AI couldn't do like being able to like figure out like, all right, charge the horses in, throw these horses back, charge this horse in here, and like cross charge and shield. It's just there's so much balancing you have to do when it comes to the game. Like honestly, the hardest part of this game is the RTS portion and not the turn-based portion, because the turn-based portion you have all the time in the world to be like, oh okay, yeah, this is this, this is this, this and this, I can go back a turn or two and redo some things, whereas the RTS section you have 10 minutes to try to win a battle, because the computer will beat you in 10 minutes even though you have a 60-minute time limit. It's fun games. There's a lot here that I wish will carry over to Warhammer 3. It won't, because Warhammer is not the setting for this. I feel this game feels like it has more of a narrative drive to it, and more of a kind of it has more emergent story play elements than Warhammer does for sure. Especially with the relationship system that it has. And Warhammer is like, as a setting and as a game, is just not built for that. Like people will say like, well yeah, well you have all these different like legendary lords that do things together. Yeah, but like the thing is, everyone in Warhammer either dies immediately when they get introduced, or just barely survives and keeps fighting for 1,000 years. So you don't get that when in Romans of the Three Kingdoms you get like your general can die, like your faction leader can die, and then you're kind of like, well shit, that was my best dude and he's gone forever. And then you have to make do. But yeah, 53 hours in, I'm happy with it, I would say.
Yeah, it sounds like it. I mean, to play it that much, I
Yeah.
imagine you'd have to enjoy it.
The one thing is that the battles are a little bit stiff for, and I can't really determine why. I think it's just because things just move really slow. But overall, it's great. They've really outdid themselves with the system. I should also mention that this game was like, it got to a point where like, it got announced. I was like, okay, cool. And then around January, I was like, all right, I'll pick up Three Kingdoms when it comes out in February, because I just like Total War games and I enjoy them. I setting's kind of interesting. And then they're like, we're going to delay it 3 months because we have some things to do. And they basically like took those 3 months and really killed it. Like it really showed from like the first previews of like the campaign and the other things compared to what it is now. Like it's insane of how much they got done in 3 months and how much it changed the game.
Delays are really good.
Delays are really good, whether they're not delayed indefinitely,
Yes.
because
Actual delays, not stealth hiatuses.
yes. I think Creative Assembly has one of the best like project management systems ever, because they crank quality work out every time, and they're not afraid to go like, hey, listen, here's the thing, this isn't working. Like we literally had like the most notorious thing that ever happened. I don't know if I ever told you this, Willer and Bradley, but so in Warhammer 1 was really cool, everyone liked it. They announced Warhammer 2, and then they were like, well, there's one more DLC for Warhammer 1, and the plan is for Warhammer 2, if you have Warhammer 1, all of the DLC and all the factions that you own from that game will transfer over to Warhammer 2, and you can play them on our huge map. It's like, sweet, cool, awesome. So before Warhammer 2 came out, they announced one last DLC faction for Warhammer 1. And they're like, yeah, got it. And if you pre-order Warhammer 2, you get that faction for free for Warhammer 1. So basically, buy the game you're going to buy anyways, make the game you already have better almost immediately. So Warhammer 2 rolls around, and they're like, hey, so it turns out there's a huge coding error in this new faction that we introduced between the two, like right between the two games. And because of that, we have to delay adding that faction into Warhammer 2 because we had to rewrite the entire faction's code.
Damn.
Yeah, there was something with like a merge error or something they didn't like comprehend, and they were just like, we're gonna have to delay it until December. It sucks, and it pushed back all their other DLC things, but they're like, trust me, we'll get it done, and it's not gonna harm any of the other quality of products for a DLC. And it really hasn't. Like, I buy all their Warhammer DLC, and it's great. But yeah, Total War Three Kingdoms. Solid 5 out of 5 for me, I think. It's gonna encapsulate me. I don't know.
It's a good game.
I probably will get back to Warhammer when they announce a new faction pack for it, but like the campaign setting for it is so good. And it's such a monumental difference that it's like Warhammer 1's campaign feels so shallow and just surface level compared to this game that it's crazy. Like Warhammer 1's campaign, you can just be like, all right, just build this because it gives me money, build this because it gives me a new unit, and then research this because I like using this unit. In this game, it just doesn't have that. And I've only like touched like an eighth of like the different changes that they made compared to the two games.
Joe, but yeah. You and these strategy games is like me and fighting games. Like,
yeah, he found his niche.
Very much.
But the thing is, I don't think I get as invested as you do in the fighting games in terms of its own mechanics. Like, I'll look at them and I'll like see the stats, but I just like, I can't.
I don't believe that for a goddamn second, Joe.
Yo, I'm gonna be over here with my Puyo shit.
Yeah, you go to your fucking corner.
You know me, dog.
Get in your fucking Tetris ass Puyo corner.
Ooh, Tetris ass.
Pull your ass, motherfucker.
Fucking hustling people out of their money.
So yeah, Total War.
Pretty good. Awesome.
And Mario says, thank you so much for playing my game.
Okay, all right.
Bob campaign, which is pretty dope, because you and your friend can just take over the world together. Or, even better, you say you're going to help him, and then you just send the spy to his faction, have the spy murder his faction leader, and then you just eliminate your friend and, like, over the... But you can do the long-term game, where it's just like, oh yeah, murder... And you're eliminated. I did it.
Bradley, right. You should play this with Joe.
Looks pretty legit. I'm every time I see gameplay, I'm like, I'm really considering it.
Yeah. You should do it because playing Space Station 13 and Puyo, you know, eventually another game will have to happen.
I mean, if those are the only two games I could play for the rest of my life, I'd probably be all right.
God damn it.
The thing is, this is probably the best optimized Total War game too. Like, other than me having like random crashes, but they've put out a patch, and I think it's just my computer's like, you've been playing this game for 4 hours. I need you to stop and give me a break.
Yeah, maybe don't.
Yeah. But yeah, man. All right.
Bradley, we're going to wrap up this podcast, but first.
Yeah, we're
going
to wrap it up. We wanted to have Attack on Titan, but we've gone over, and we want Willer to have more time to talk about how. Yeah. Apparently fucking awesome this season is.
It's the season's ongoing, so I'm gonna talk about it next week, and it'll be the same. All right,
so
send us off with a hypothetical question.
My hypothetical situation to you guys is, you know that scene in Avengers Endgame where
spoilers
I mean it's been out for a month. I hope people who care have seen it by now.
Surely.
So spoiler. If you care and you haven't seen it, then leave. In Avengers Endgame, when Captain Marvel slams down and she's like, hey, Peter Parker, got something for me? you know what I'm talking about.
You mean the best fucking scene?
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Ara-Ara, Peter-kun.
Peter-kun. So it's a normal day, right? You're outside walking on the sidewalk. I don't know if that's a normal day for us. We don't really leave the house, but I don't know. You're walking down the sidewalk, normal day, and Captain Marvel herself, Brie Larson, slams down on the sidewalk in front of you. And she's like, "Hey, Joe Lloyd, got something for me? What are you giving her? What are you giving her? What do you do? What do you do? What do you say?
What are you giving her, Joe?
What are you giving her?
She's mugging me. I mean, Willer, what are you giving her?
How do you respond? You don't even have to give her something.
Bradley asked you first. What do you mean?
I'd be like, Jesus, Christ, oh Lord."
What do you say? Do you run away? Do you Do you piss your pants?
Take out my wallet.
Take all my money. Don't kill me.
It's like, can you take me here, please?
Oh,
Because if I'm walking in the street, I'm probably
yeah.
lost.
Well,
All right, Willard De Silva, got something for me?
ooh, well, you see, I'm a big fan of Brie Larson as an actress, and she's quite the QT.
But this is Brie Larson. This is Captain Marvel, who also happens to look like Brie Larson and happens to not have her ass as well.
Ooh, that is a
Ooh.
factor. That suit. But it's fine. You know what? I engage in conversation and I give her what she needs. Whatever that may be.
What is it?
I don't know, Brad, whatever, man. Bradley made this up. Bradley, how do you answer your own question?
I'd probably ask her if she wants to play Animal Crossing New Leaf on my new Nintendo 3DS.
Oh, God damn
That's all the time I got today.
I would,
All
though.
right. Goodbye, everyone.